and gentlemen, and welcome to the Darkling Plane. This is the mythical realm where all lost podcast recordings dwell. That's right, listener. Not all podcasts see the light of day. Some are marred by poor or incomplete audio, or fraught with time-sensitive content, and so they are abandoned and left to torment in this accursed place. Until today. In this Halloween special, we shall be exhuming some of the ghosts of Kingsgrave's past. Our first podcast comes from June of 2014. It was an episode of DragonCast, in which the crew reviewed the penultimate episode of Game of Thrones' fourth season. By all accounts, it was a witty and entertaining critique, but upon ending the Skype call, it was discovered that half the audio was missing. It exists now only in the memories of those who were present that day. However, the Aftershow did survive and is presented to you now for your listening displeasure. Ha ha ha.
I think from what I've seen, it's about as split as we are. There's some people that were really into it, some people that were really bored with the wall storyline, didn't want to have a full episode on this. I think there's definitely a lot of split opinions. But yeah, like, I also felt really like I was expecting Stannis, and I was like, what? There's no more? Because, like you say, it ends so early. The actual, like, time of the episode ends early. And I think that if they had wanted to, they could have fit it in, but I think that they were making a deliberate choice to have one climax here with the Ygritte, Jon Snow thing, and then move this other big climactic moment into another episode.
Yeah, I understand it. It took me a while to calm down, because my first post in the forums after was like, no Stannis, what the fuck? Because that's, for a year, we've been looking forward to the Battle of the Wall, Stannis' rescue, and it just, you know, I was like, there's 10 minutes left. I kept pausing. I was like, okay, 10 minutes, there's plenty of time. And because the battle had ended, and there was 7 minutes left. It's like, okay, Ygritte, it's fine. And then 3 minutes, and then they're in a tunnel. Like, there's 1 minute left, and then I paused it, and I saw, like, the three frames ahead that it was black, and I literally just said, what the, it was just... It's frustrating, but
I've wait next down. Episode we're gonna have him back on Dragonstone because he forgot something.
Well, don't even joke, Zach.
Sorry.
I kind of take the other stance. Like, I'm excited for Stannis to get there, but that would have annoyed me if the people from the wall had fought so hard and held these people off, and, you know, I mean, yeah, they still have a lot to do, but then, oh, Stannis shows up to save them, you know. Yeah, I like how they did it. Like, they won this one, you know, there's a lot more to do, but it kind of gave them the focus of this episode, so I was happy with how they did it.
Yeah, I agree. Stannis not showing up till the next episode doesn't bother me.
Yeah, it was just kind of like that initial reaction, like, what, they're not doing it? But obviously, they're going to push it off.
I'm fine with it now.
But I definitely said at the end, I was like, oh my god, people are going to be so mad. But actually, the reaction was a lot tamer than I thought would be.
Well, it also because I like Stannis, he's one of my favorite characters, and a lot of people couldn't give two shits about Stannis, so they don't really care if he shows up and rescues everybody.
It is, even if you don't like Stannis, like though, me. You have to appreciate that moment, I think. Like, I don't like Stannis that much, but I really like that moment.
Yeah.
I think it is kind of good that they left him out for several episodes, so that kind of he's out of sight, out of mind, so that when he does show up, you know, it'll have the desired effect, hopefully.
Yeah, that was the worry, actually, back when we got that first Stannis scene, that they were going to, like, show a bunch of stuff with him and not have that time to forget about him, but I think they have managed that despite
stuff. Yeah, I'm glad they didn't show him, like, mustering his troops or getting, like, everybody together in Braavos. That's the last scene was Davos, you know, joking with Salador, so they're kind of in the background for it'll be four episodes when they come back, so definitely.
Those are going to be like some sort of setup scene, and if so, what would work?
I hope there's no setup scene. I hope it's literally thundering hooves through the through the woods.
That'll be awesome for those who love that moment in the books, but will it matter to, like, the TV audience at all?
If they do it the right way, I think they can make it epic for anyone without any kind of context even. I think that it's just going to depend on how they frame it.
Yeah, I think it's surprising any time that any characters meet that aren't normally together. You know, it's really cool when they cross paths or, you know, end up in the same location. So I think it'll have that impact.
It'll be interesting to see how they play that. I'm very curious, because I think that they could do it really poorly. Like, if Stannis runs in with, like, his five pirates, and those guys take out all the wildlings, that would be terrible.
Son and Melisandre. Oh, no,
I want to see that. No, Melisandre, she's got to set an eagle on fire. Mm. Or I am not. I mean, I know there's no Varamyr six skins or whatever, but I want some animal. Sorry, animals. I want some fake Aldebaran.
When are we going to do a chapter reread of The Wit and Wisdom of Tyrion Lannister?
I heard that book was terrible.
It's not terrible. Oh God, it's just, it is what it is. It's a collection of Tyrion's quotes with nice illustrations. That's all it is.
I knew what I was getting when I ordered it.
I can't
is it book
you.
Quotes or TV show quotes?
No, it's all from the books.
It's all book quotes.
They're not all his. I remember that there was some posts online where people were like, but he didn't even say this. This is something that's said to him or about him.
No, there's like, some about him. There's some conversations that he's
shadow. He doesn't say that. But again, whatever. It's worth it for the illustration, I think, maybe.
All those creepy-looking Tyrion illustrations.
Yeah, he looks like a mini Willem Dafoe. No, he doesn't. They didn't give him a beard.
Oh, God, and that's so creepy. In my head, that's what he looks like.
Yeah, he may look like that, but I don't want to look at it.
No, I wouldn't buy it and put it on my coffee table.
They're pretty much all him.
You were, like, literally flipping through it to cross-reference this shit. Of course you are.
I've heard the food in hell is wretched.
That's not even fun. That's terrible.
That's,
I mean, especially out of context. Like, so much of what he says packs a punch because of the other shit around it.
A man grows weary of having no lovers but his fingers. Classic.
does it actually trail off?
Classic.
Whatever. Are there any quotes in that book that are spoken in dance?
Yeah, one is a dance quote.
I don't know. I'm asking. Is it? I don't know. I don't remember.
Because a lot of people were angry when they came out. They're like, oh, we heard there was a new Tyrion book, and there's nothing new here. It's just quotes. It's like, yeah,
Tyrion
that's what
book.
It says. A new Ice and Fire book.
Yeah. Oh, shit. I bet that was a disappointment.
Yeah, that's what. If you look at the reviews on Amazon, there's like 6 one-star reviews. People are like, this is
the Winds of Winter. Yeah. Why is George spending his time compiling this list of quotes that he probably didn't even do anything with?
Dummies.
Amazon trolled the shit out of me last week. I got an email about George R. R. Martin's new book, and it was, you know, Wild Aces or whatever his side projects are.
Oh, Rogues? The new one, Rogues?
Yeah, Rogues.
Well, that's going to be good. That's going to have Princess and the Queen thing. Yeah.
I actually just started reading some of his short stories that I had never really read any. I read one or two of his stories, but I think Amin is doing a BOK episode that I might be on. I'm not sure, but they're really good, like hard science fiction. And I always thought he was more fantasy, but it's mostly science fiction. But there's some really good ones.
Okay,
Sand Kings is like one of the best stories I've ever read.
Let's learn. Like, what is the story that he wrote that has something to do with, like, basically bugs or some life form?
Sand Kings.
Can...
Yeah, it's like
we wrote that in eighth grade.
Well, he published them in like 74. Yeah, he's got all these stories that are set in this universe, and that's one of them. Yeah, but it's this guy on like this planet has collects crazy pets, and he has, it's like ants that come to life and kill everybody. But it's,
it is fucking awesome. I cannot believe that was assigned reading in eighth grade. I got real lucky.
And Song for Lyra has Lyanna and Rob as the two main characters. So, you know, he had those names way back in 1972, whenever he wrote it.
Rob.
With two B's.
They're probably part of his D&D game.
Yeah.
Not super great at the fantasy names, which I appreciate, quite frankly. I like that aspect. That's what makes Marine difficult sometimes for people, especially. I just go Shade Pate and people who aren't Shade Pate.
I just want to ask, I'd love to ask him how he like thinks of those Marine names. Like, they're so out there. I don't know. There must be some kind of cultural like inspiration, but it's pretty crazy.
I feel like if there were an association, somebody would have parsed it out by now.
I'm sure there's something there.
Yeah, it seems like there's some kind of grammatical thing going on, like of, you know, the zo or lo or whatever, you know, because I don't know.
The zomo.
Like yeah.
He's making it as
the zomo lo.
Possible.
Well, you know, like Spanish names are like de, this or whatever, you know.
Right.
So that's kind of what I was thinking of.
Yeah. And they could have been
day,
but
bar. There's bin. There's you know, there's a ben.
Sun. Yeah. Something. Yeah.
Z's and Q's, so I figured he did that on purpose, just to otherize a bit more. I'm not sure to a great end yet. We'll have to see how the rest of that story plays out.
I still don't understand the whole Grand Northern conspiracy. I felt like if that existed, it would be much more on the pages and more people would have picked up on it.
Oh my God.
I hope it exists, but I don't really...
Why? Why do you hope it exists?
Because
what do you want to see?
Well, I'd like to see Rickon on the you know, be king in the North.
Oh, okay, so. Wait. Okay, so your GNC is Rickon centric, not Jon Snow centric.
It can be, yeah. I hope it's more Rickon. That makes more sense to me. But yeah, because I can't see like Winnie Dustin giving two fucks about Jon Snow.
It's Rob's son that the Blackfish snuck away.
But there's so much. That's He's not enough game. Time for that. That's like a grand conspiracy for.
I don't care. That's my theory. That's not my theory, but that's
I think you're having
your
episode right now, Brooke. So get it over with, whatever you have to say.
I'm not. I feel like the GNC stuff. I also feel like that baby inside of Jane was an original plan that he maybe decided to change his mind on.
Oh, because of the hips. With like, the hips.
Well, not just. I mean, that was a legitimate error. Things happen, yeah. But things are much made of it. But the simple fact that you know she was trying to get pregnant and that. It is kind of in this house's best interest for her to do so, actually. So, like, her mom keeping her from getting pregnant makes zero sense. And so maybe it was all set up, and then at the last, like, the next time he's writing this book, after the gap, he's like, I don't really like the way this is. So she can just go the way of, you know, probably people like Cereal Pharrell. We'll never know. Blackfish will show back up, but she's gone.
Cereal Pharrell is alive.
Schrodinger's Cereal, we'll never know. I choose to believe that he made it out, but I know I'll never find out for sure. I made him a piece of that.
How? How could he have made it out? I want him to be made out to get out as much as you, but how could he possibly have escaped?
He poked
well,
him dude in the eye with a stick and hauled ass after Arya got escaped.
But Meryn Trant had fucking armor.
No, I
not over his eyes. He's the first order Bravos, baby. He poked him in the eye after he ducked and weaved for about 10 minutes, if he could do that. And then after he was sure Arya got away, he poked him in the eye and hauled ass out of town.
The only way he could have escaped is if he did the thing that in the Monty Python Life of Brian, where he just ran in circles and had them chase him until they passed out, and then he wins the gladiatorial contest. That's the only way he could have.
You're saying like that's not a possibility. I mean, it could happen.
I just proved myself wrong.
I like that we'll not know that one. So back to GNC. No, I guess I don't like it because I don't believe that there will be seven kingdoms or any kingdoms at all somehow at the very end. So, like, I really don't.
I don't even think there's going to be one continent by the end of it. I think the whole neck is going to go up and the children of the forest are going to get what they tried to do 5,000 years ago, whatever. That's my
sure.
Hope.
Okay. But see, is that in the best interest of the people that live on that continent at this point, though? Would that be good?
For the south, I think the north is fucked. I think everything, I don't think they can hold it back.
Some sort of big climatic fantasy event seems contrary to the spirit of the series, though.
Agreed. I cannot picture these moments that people always talk about, and maybe because I haven't read enough like epic high fantasy to just have that stuff in my head. But
oh no, I don't mean like the children are going to make some weird magic, but it's all building towards that. You've got to have some climax, and I know it's been a slow build with the magic and the dragons, but it's been building, so we've got to have something.
No, you're right.
What if we don't?
I don't mind if we don't, but I think it would be a waste of our lives if we don't. Maybe.
that's a big one.
Not really. I just.
Right, that they would split the continent off with people, like human beings, are in the south, and the north is them and the walkers or whatever. Not everybody in the north who lives in the north right now, up to and including people that we like, are stuck up there.
No, I mean, I want a major awesome battle between the Golden Company and the forces of the Lannisters and the I want that too. I never really read fantasy before this, except from Tolkien, so I would much rather it be an actual military, you know, but we've got dragons and we've got Bran and we've got. Well, Bran's just going to be recording everything because he can't actually do anything, but we've got the others. So,
Blood Raven! Fuck yes! Sorry, I just got
started. Oh, we're going to see Blood Raven next episode, too. That's going to be fun.
I felt like there was nothing left to look forward to because I'm kind of dreading what's going to happen with Tyrion. I'm so afraid of how they'll handle it. Hopefully, I'll be wrong. And now I'm afraid. You made me so afraid about Lady Stoneheart. Like,
yeah, if they were getting Stoneheart, I just feel like they're keeping it so they're hiding it so well because I have a bad feeling that we're not going to get Stoneheart.
Speaking of Blood Raven again, do you guys think we're ever going to get a Dunk and Egg where we get that whole thing with Aemon being escorted up to the wall by Dunk and Blood Raven 2?
I hope so, because I'm actually looking forward to that more than Summerhall. I just want to see them all together.
We don't get Aegon there because he'd be a king. He wouldn't go with them.
No, but he would have been there to send him off.
Right, he'd be at the beginning.
I think we will get it if he finishes the Dunk and Egg series that he has in his mind.
No, I don't think we'll get it. I think it's sad to hope.
Well, he does do a lot of time skips in it.
Just now.
I could conceive of it being the one after the next one.
Me too, if he still wants to continue the story that way. And I swear to God, somebody sent me something recently, like at the day after this episode aired, some interview where he's talking about it's going to be probably maybe 8 books. And I'm thinking, well, obviously, of course it's going to be 8 books, which to me, by the way, is awesome. I want 8 books. I want 9 or 10, assuming they...
I can't go down to Wheel of Time territory with this because I, like, just, I...
Oh, I would stop. It'll... There's no continuing, but I...
Yeah, but that didn't surprise me one bit. I mean, the story's just more and more meandering. Like, it's going to take a while to reel it back in. So
I'm fine with that. And I'm
and I'm okay, to be honest, yeah.
Yeah, but we could also lose half of our POV characters in the next book, which would really condense the story down.
Could we? I mean, but yes, but then he might just start killing.
We really don't need all of those POVs. They could easily die. I don't think anyone would get
like upset. Like Dick Tarion. I feel like he's out at some point in the next
Barristan.
Book. Barristan's gone. We don't need him.
Danny, don't need her.
Danny continues until at least the last week. You know, this has to happen.
John's already gone. He's dead.
John is technically out. Unless
what
we
do you
get,
think?
Like,
do y'all think what's happening in King's Landing will have any bearing on what happens in the North? I mean, it seems like they're totally different, you know, stories. Like, they really have nothing going on together.
The way I think they're setting it up is King's Landing will at least be involved in the whole thing with Aegon, which will be involved with Dany, and Dany will be involved in the North. Like, that's how...
It's like, what's going to happen to Cersei? Does she have anything to do with, you know? Like, she seems like a character that has totally nothing to do with what's going on with the Wall. I guess...
Right, but, I mean, who cares, right? Does it all have to be about the Wall?
No.
Well, that's where he ended it.
I mean, I understand the impression, and, like, it all has to be about that, but I also think it's weird, like, over the course of reading the book, I originally started out thinking, you guys are so distracted, Battle for All Humanity, right there. And then I thought, if we're so focused on Battle for All Humanity, we are literally not living the lives that we are living. So they're both really, really relevant, and it's also important to note how, like, the shit in King's Landing directly impacts the Wall in that they don't get the people they need, the funds they need, the support that they need, etc. And so that's
most of the people in Westeros are going to die during the winter anyway because there's no food stored up because of the war.
Also true. We're going to lose not any POV characters, but surely 2/3 of the small folk. Thanks a lot, fucking Blackfish. God, so mean. Architect and Gardener, I had a debate with my viewers last week, people I watched with. Do you guys actually think it's possible to only be one or the other, or do they not have to exist?
No, I think there's definitely a bit of both. Like, even if he doesn't want to admit it, it's weird because they're, like, ambiguous terms, because he says he's a gardener, but he still has, like, a plot of what's going on, like, he's structured it out. So, I don't know, it's weird, like, how far you have to go to be considered one or the other.
I'm sorry, who are you talking about? George?
Well, George has done thing where, like...
concept in general, even.
Where, like, you're either a writer who plans everything out ahead of time and has a very strict structure, or you're the kind of one that, like,
you let the
stuff out as you go.
The story. That was one of the big sticking points for someone last week, was this idea of letting the character story tell you where the character needs to go next. Like, I'm about both, but...
I think it's one of those sliding scale things where, like, you're not one or the other, but you're somewhere on the scale.
He kind of started off I guess on the gardening side, where he just had like visions of this happening and this happening, and it kind of melded into a story. But now we know that he has, you know, at least in broad strokes, what happens. He's not just, I don't hope he's not doing, well, let's see where this takes me.
I think he's got some major plot points, but then he kind of like lets it unfold in between. But he's got to have like a bunch planned because there's tons of foreshadowing, you know, so.
I like his road trip comparison more than the architect gardener, because I think it really encapsulates things like his like whole thing about like he knows where he's going, but if he finds something along the way that's interesting, he'll explore it.
He's a greenhouse gardener.
I think we came to like a closing argument that I like the travelogues, and that ultimately I would like we all just feel like we got burned by Lost.
Yeah, but the first time you read the books, did you love Feast and Dance as much as on rereads? Because
I read them together first. They're my favorite book, hands down.
I read them as they came out for the last two, but I definitely felt, not disappointed, but they're a little, just that I didn't get that, because it just was such a build-up. For me, not so much Danny, but just because the battle in the North, it happened, we just didn't find out about it. That's kind of what we're led to believe with the whole letter. I just wish we would have had that kind of closure to it, and... That was my only.
No, that I. But I understand.
Loved I loved her whole battle with Shagwell and I loved what that led up to. But yeah, Dance was not as slow as people made it out to be.
I knew already going in there was not going to be Like, I knew it ended with John getting stabbed. I didn't expect a battle. I knew it ended with Danny off in the world. I knew everything. So I wasn't expecting it. So my experience with it was completely different.
Yeah, that,
and I can absolutely see how reading it, like, just structurally, it does build up. And it feels like there's about 300 pages of content that should have happened climactically that don't. So that, I understand it. I love the two together. God, they're great. My favorite book.
I think the stuff in them I really like. Like, I really love the Theon bits of dance, and there's bits of Feast I like too. Like, I like the Cersei stuff. I like some of the Dorne stuff. It's kind of back and forth. But I really hate the Aeron Greyjoy, and like some of that stuff that kills me. Like, that one Aeron Greyjoy chapter where he's like rallying people to go to the Kingsmen.
Oh,
it took me like 2 weeks to read that one chapter. It was so bad.
Yeah. Where he's talking, well, that one is kind of bland. We do meet the reader, but it is mostly set up. But it's so creepy when you go backwards and you're trying to think about, like, the fuck is this guy anyway, and why am I reading him? Why does he matter? Sorry, I said all this in Queen's Moon, so.
Yeah, I had some reactions similar to that, Zach, with Cersei's, because it wasn't so much what happened in the Cersei chapter, is that it seemed like every other chapter was a Cersei chapter, and I just wanted other shit to go down, and I just would do the thing where, like, I'd flip to see what the next three chapters were, and it would be like Cersei Brienne. I was like, just I need to know what's going on elsewhere. And he puts that little end of the book where he's like, meanwhile, back on the wall. If he had that at the beginning, I'd have known that going in, but it was at the end of the book where he explained the process of how the book had to be divided up and everything. I was like, well, that would have been nice to know ahead of time.
I think I knew beforehand that they weren't going to be in, but there was like this weird feeling like maybe, like, I don't know, yeah. Like, I was aware of the whole, like, I was aware of the feeling that people get in Feast were like, what are these new characters? I'm so confused, but I still kind of expected like some of the old stuff. But looking back, I think there's stuff to be enjoyed in there, even though it's different.
I love all the Brienne stuff. I know a lot of people don't. I like it for the descriptive randomness of the places, but like, it's not entirely clear to me yet why she was made a POV character and why we followed that particular story.
Well, the part that really kills it is the going like, to Crack Cloud Point and then nothing.
Oh, no, that's one of my favorites.
If that was all just leading towards like Stoneheart, that wasn't needed.
That's why I like it. This whole chapter about this like creepy, weird place and all, it's in this. Like, just saying,
my favorite line of the book, maybe, of Shagwell saying, "You can't kill me. I'm so very droll."
Plus, I mean, that creepy, fucking, weird mystery castle thing that they're in, and like that every area is unique and has their own way of doing things and has their own. I mean, it was almost exactly across the continent from where the Greyjoys are doing their thing, and so just a reminder that not everything happens up north or in Dorne. And it's not all Dany. Like, there are actual other places.
Yeah, I mean, when I was reading it, I was like, okay, you know, like, I was really wanting something to happen. But now, like, looking back, I'm glad there was all this world building, because it just feels so much richer, you know, than if it was just, like, thing after thing happening. Yeah.
True.
Yeah, because a lot happens. A lot happens. So.
Our second podcast also comes from June of 2014. It was the second installment of the SoccerCast and would have provided a preview for the upcoming World Cup series. But at 4 hours, the recording was so large and unwieldy that it consumed every cutting instrument that tried to touch it.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Vassals of Kingsgrave, the soccer cast part 2. In Britain, they call it football, but in the free world, we call it soccer. My name is Augustine, known as LineCom1 on the forums. I'm known as the podcast doctor, and I'm happy to be joined by a few co-hosts from around the world. Before we get to them, though, just to fill you guys in, all five of you that are listening, in case you didn't hear from the last episode, I'm a diehard Manchester United fan. It's a team that I came to love through Jisung Park, who's my favorite player. And we had a very interesting season. I can't say that it was fun, but it certainly was interesting. So the first guest host I have is you might know her from every episode of Vassals of Kingsgrave ever recorded. She's our chief Britain correspondent. I think one of her turn-ons is Excel spreadsheets, but it's Bina 007 from the forums.
Hey, everybody. It's Golden Bina.
Golden Bina.
Yeah, oh, I've decided that we should all have stupid World Cup nicknames.
Okay, Golden Vina. Do you want to remind everyone which team you're representing and why?
I'm representing Spurs. It's an inherited disability. And yeah, there's not much more to say about it. We had an awful season.
Okay, and next up, coming all the way from the exotic locale of Michigan, is Paz Plight from the forums. You might know him from the soccer thread. He's one of the main contributors there. It's Paz Plight.
Yes, I'm known as Paul, and I hadn't prepared a special name like Golden Vina, but yeah.
Silver Paul.
Happy to be here. Silver Paul.
I love how you say I'm known as Paul. Is Paul not your real name?
It is. But that's...
All right, Paul. So can you just tell us which team you root for and why you would root for such a horrible team like that?
I root for Liverpool, as you may know from the previous podcast. And why do I root for them? Just because I always have since many years. I don't know why I began it, but that's how it is, and it's awesome.
And I have to say, most neutral followers of the Premier League would have such admiration for what Liverpool achieved this season. I mean, hats off. Great season for them.
It's Bing, coming all the way from Beijing, China. Bing, are you there?
Hello. Yep, I'm here. Hi, it's Bing.
So some of us remember you from the KrakenCast. For those of us that listen to that. Can you tell us actually a little bit about yourself and which team you root for?
Hi, I'm Bing. Shoe China Uniforms. Pretty recent joinee in the SoCerCast on Ice and Fire podcast forum. I'm a graduate student. That's why I'm in Beijing this year, studying and researching.
Nice.
But I root for nobody in the English Premiership because my English team is currently screwing around in the fucking championship. Blackburn Rovers.
Hey, hang on. We might have an American audience, so we have to explain what relegation is. Relegation is when the three bottom shittiest teams in the league get kicked out to the minor leagues, and the three best teams from the minor leagues get kicked up. So that's what happened to Shushan's team.
But yes, Blackburn, we were eighth in the championship this season, which means we missed out on the playoffs. And the sad thing is, I'm very proud that this team actually finished eighth because I had much lower expectations of them this season.
What brought you to Blackburn? That's not a typical team for someone who isn't supposed to follow. Do you have like some family?
Blackburn's in Blackburn. No. Blackburn is in Lancashire. It's actually pretty close to Manchester.
It's a northern city.
Yeah. I supported Blackburn because I was the original bandwagon jumper. I just started supporting them in 1995 when they were good. And they won the Premiership. That's when I started watching football.
And it's been downhill ever since.
Hey, it went downhill, and then we went back up and won the. It was called the Carling Cup back then, but now it's just the League Cup. And then some people took us over and took us all the way down.
Shit, man, that's terrible.
So if you had this investor investing a lot of money into your team, how did you guys get relegated?
The investor was completely clueless about every single football decision they made. They bought the wrong players. They hired a guy as a global advisor, which is any other team has that position. And I don't know what he actually did. I don't know, get us relegated. We hired and fired four managers in a single season. There's many things that can help you get relegated, apparently.
Wow. So that's an interesting, that's a unique perspective, I think, Bing will bring to the group what it's like to be so bad you got kicked out at home. Next up on the podcast, we have a first-time participant of the Vassals of Kingsgrave. He is calling all the way from Down Under in Australia, and his name is Vidur. Can you hear us, Vidur?
Yeah, I can. Yeah, hi.
Hey, Vidur. Can you go ahead and introduce yourself? Just tell us your forum name and tell us how you got into A Song of Ice and Fire.
Oh, my forum name is VColor13. I'm also quite a recent poster on the forums. And yeah, I think I got into Song of Ice and Fire actually after the first season of Game of Thrones. And I watched the first season and was pretty much immediately hooked. And then I read like all the books in pretty much 2 months' time. And it's amazing.
Whereabouts are you based, Vid? Are you in Melbourne, where all the other, like, we've got a lot of Song of Ice and Fire fans there?
I'm in Canberra, so
wow.
I'm like in the small like capital city in between Melbourne and Sydney.
Okay.
So you didn't go to the
Have you been there?
No, it was the one capital city I didn't go to because they didn't have a test match there, so there was no need. I went to all the other capitals.
Yeah, they actually host the Prime Minister's 11 before the Ashes. So I went in 2010.
Oh, cool. I think. So you into cricket too? Because I want to get a cricket podcast together.
Oh, yeah, I'd be very interested. Yeah, definitely.
Awesome. Okay. Because so far it's just like me, Jed, and Ted who are into cricket.
So, Vitter, can you tell us which team you root for in the Premier League and how you got into them in the first place?
I root for Liverpool, and I've rooted for them since 2005 in that famous night in Istanbul where they came back and won the Champions League. And I think what really sold the team to me was the Liverpool rap. Have any of you heard that?
I have not heard it. Can you explain
that for us right now?
Like, oh, I can't do it. I'm not actually from Merseyside, so it would be insulting for me to try. Yeah, I don't know the words, but it's amazing, and I recommend everybody to search that up on YouTube.
So you started liking Liverpool because of a rap song?
I think
because of Champions League.
It's not just a rap song though. It's like a touchstone in rap music and yeah, it's amazing.
See, I'm a fan of rap music, but I'm very just disappointed that rap music would ever bring someone to like Liverpool.
It's amazing.
Hasn't died.
So next up we have a very special guest. This is he's not our chief correspondent from Britain, but he is our expert in North London culture. He's basically the John Mayer of North London. You might have heard his voice from the Christmas episode of a podcast of Ice and Fire. It's Gerard.
Hi guys, how's it going?
Hey Gerard, what's your forum name?
Jeddo Whitehart.
All right, and which team do you root for and why?
The mighty Spurs. Ever since I went to see them in the early 70s, Dad took us up, got into your blood as soon as you walk out and up the steps and out of the pitch there, and you get the roar of the crowd. Sort of gets into your blood and stays there.
All right,
through good times and bad.
So you were sort of inherited, and that was like sort of a family team that you guys cheered for.
Yeah, my dad and my uncles all used to go up and watch the double side in the early 60s. We just live about 20 miles north of London, about 15 miles from Tottenham, I suppose. It's more or less our nearest team.
You are also part of the infamous, what do you guys call it, the British moot? The English moot?
Or the Cockney moot.
The Cockney moot, that's it.
Yeah.
It's when all the stuck-up British people all like get together and hang out, which is actually pretty cool.
What's your big deal with like stuck up snobby?
Where do you get this idea that we're stuck up?
And I think you guys have a big gathering this weekend, right? Because of your birthday.
Yeah, it's my 50th birthday.
Well, happy birthday, man!
Thanks very much.
Yeah. Happy birthday! Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm really looking forward to it. In fact, I'm sitting in amongst all the decorations for the hall. We've got severed heads lying around and big wheel candelabras and. I've got my Baratheon helmet there.
Are there going to be dancing dwarves?
My cousin is going as Shay, and she is trying her utmost to get a dwarf to go with her. I don't know if she's succeeding. If she does, then I think she's going to win the fancy dress competition, hands down, if she manages to unearth one.
I have a question for you, because you are a British native. And what's the feeling in Britain as it pertains to Manchester City's finish, and basically the finish of all the top clubs, Chelsea and Liverpool and Man City? I mean, does anyone feel like they sort of stumbled across the finish line? Because these are all teams who dropped the ball and sort of defaulted at winning.
Yeah, right? I think everyone thinks really enjoyed the season because it was competitive. There was a lot of lead changes at the top, and everyone had a chance. I think Liverpool probably would have been the neutrals' favourite because they played such great attacking football, like, you know. But the depth of squad and the money involved, you know, from Chelsea and Man City sort of showed through at the end, really. And everyone pretty much ended up where they should, apart from Man United, you know, considering the resources.
How would you say you feel about Tottenham's overall season?
Yeah, very disappointing, obviously. It's always going to be hard after losing Bale, but spent all that money and you think, well, there must be a few good players, but didn't pan out. It takes most foreign players at least a year to sort of settle into the Premiership, so I think it's just the pace of the Premier League, of course, for as long as the Premiership, and you really have to be an athlete and be prepared to mix it in the Premiership, whereas the foreign leagues you can get a little bit more. Is that a word?
So, Bia, did you expect you got the Spurs to finish higher, or are you pretty much not surprised with the finish?
I expected us to finish maybe one or two places higher than we did. It was always going to be tough losing Bale. I thought we bought actually better on paper than it felt like at the end of the season. I think it was, as usual, mostly to do with manager and really manager interaction with Levy. And I think it was either a wrong choice or he wasn't backed enough, but it just didn't work out. And it just feels like a completely wasted season. Like, we built up such momentum in the Bale years and it's just completely gone now.
Yeah.
And it's hard to know with Pochettino, like what he's going to be given that's different, like how he's going to be able to make much of a difference.
So the problem, you think, was that, because it obviously wasn't money, right? Because they had plenty of money to spend last summer. And, do you think AVB just didn't fit because of, like, communication problems?
Yeah, he didn't get the best out of the players, obviously. I mean, Soldado's a proven goal scorer, and he played him up front on his own, which, you know, in a narrow formation, it was like he thrives off of crosses, and he wasn't getting any crosses in at all.
Where he played people. Some of the team selection was perverse. Like, people he'd leave on the bench, he'd just be like, I can't believe you just did that.
Who were some of the players that he would leave out?
He hardly played Lamella, who was sort of one of the top players in Italy last year. Yeah. And he played in one game, and he had a really good game. He won a penalty, scored a goal in the Europa League. And he'd got a bit of confidence. He was flying, and he was immediately dropped for the following game. And I don't think we've seen him since, really. And he was the best part of 30 million, I think. Yeah. Well, I assume he'll be on his way. It depends, again, if the new manager can sort of talk him around and get him on side. It does take time to gel in anyway, and so many new players. I would have preferred to have got some players that had Premiership experience already, but we bought them all from outside, and they were sort of a gamble. I thought Paulinho was really poor. I thought he had a terrible season, really. Just don't see anything from him. I hope he improves. I don't see what anybody saw in him to start with, really.
He was great in the Confederations Cup, I think, a year ago.
Yeah, yeah, so I hear.
And he's going to start for Brazil in this summer's World Cup.
I know, yeah, I can't believe it.
where are Spurs' biggest needs then this offseason, Bina?
Well, I think the problem is the biggest problem was the manager. And we've already appointed the new manager, and so we can't change that now. It's done, and I just don't think it's the right choice. And I think the biggest problem with Spurs has never been the players. It's been the people deploying them, and, you know, Levy's not going anywhere, and that's maybe our biggest problem. So I'm quite forlorn. Like, I approached the new season with quite some despondency.
Oh, Bina.
Sad face.
We were so nearly there, weren't we, a couple of years ago?
Exactly.
So close to challenging.
Exactly. It just felt like
I love how the Champions League
on the verge of greatness. There was such buzz around the club, and
Levy gets rid of Harry, and then it's all gone.
When you guys watch Gareth Bale basically shine on the Champions League stage, basically helping them win not only the Champions League but also the Spanish Cup tournament, is that like watching your ex-girlfriend like date a guy that's probably like a much better looking than you are or something?
It's like if an ex-boyfriend dated Angelina Jolie. It hurts.
So were your hearts broken watching Champions League final?
No, but I tell you what, I love Gareth Bale, and I don't blame him for going. Yeah. He wanted, you know, because he was born Welsh, he can't play for England, so, like, he needs to make it count on the world stage, which is Champions League, and he's so talented, he gave so much to Spurs that I can't resent him from going. And he's such a lovely guy. I just resent us for not spending the money better and getting more out of it, and, you know, good luck to him. I wish him very well.
Dear vassals of Kingsgrave, I was touched by your interest in my views about the upcoming World Football Cup tournament. I do love association football, and though it had been rumored that I am an Arsenal supporter, I can confirm that my father never took me up the arse on Saturday afternoon when I was young. As for the England team, I am in a very buoyant mood about our fine young lads' chances. I think Mr. Hodgson has done an excellent job as far as selecting the squad, and I am extremely pleased he did not select Mr. Defoe. He is even shorter in stature than myself, and also seems to have less understanding of the offside rule. He may have achieved a few goals after his move to Toronto, but I think you'll agree that even the unsullied could score in the MLS. I understand that the team are disappointed Mr. Terry is not in the squad, but that is probably because their wives are at home and now they cannot keep an eye on him. I am disappointed that the portly Mr. Lampard is in the squad, but I am thrilled with our dashing Lancastrian captain, Mr. Gerrard, and I am quietly confident he will lead us to the trophy. Mr. Gerrard, he'll pass the ball 40 yards. He's big and he's fucking hard. Mr. Gerrard. Two other matters. On the very rare occasions that England have had to lower themselves to play the unwashed ginger picts from beyond the wall, one must side with the educated, cultured, and well-mannered nation of England. Although one does feel a tinge of remorse for the sweaty socks, as Philip calls them, as they have some delightful whiskey-soaked supporters who lend an exciting atmosphere to all their games, despite the inevitability of their defeat. They have had some splendid players in the dim and distant past, although their goal custodians have always left a lot to be desired, being about as good at catching as Davos or a post-Zolo Jamie. I would rule out completely a combined British team, as the sweaty socks are in no way fit to lace our sweaty boots. However, Charles' gang of Celts have produced a couple of wonderful exponents of the beautiful game. Mr. Bale would be a most welcome addition to the side, as would, in his day, Mr. Giggs. As for your pertinent question of why do England suck at penalty kicks, it has been a constant source of irritation to me, and I have sometimes considered offering my own services in training, as being German myself, I never miss. I rarely follow international football between tournaments, so I hesitate to make a list of favourites, as I am, if you will forgive the expression, an ignorant ranker. But if pushed, I would have to say, number one, Germany. Number two, Germany. And number three, Germany. As for our temporary former colony, the United States of America. We shall take you back after you've sorted your gun obsession out. I would have to say, despite my admiration for Mr. Altidore and Mr. Dempsey, there is more chance of a live television show of me performing fellatio on the Pope than of them winning the trophy. I do hope you all enjoy the tournament and England's ensuing victory. And please remember, God save your gracious me, long live your noble me, God save me. Send me victorious, happy and glorious, heart save the penalties, God save me. A long live a house of me and Woody.
This next clip comes from the CockneyMoot meetup held in July of 2014, in which the attendees performed a full castle recording of Tyrion's 11th chapter from A Storm of Swords. The audio was mostly unusable, and so the chapter reading was re-recorded for VOK 120. However, this is an outtake from the original event.
And how bad she must want a real cock in place of the dwarf's stunted little thing.
Most like it's got a croak in it.
Would you rather I did it in a different accent or more a dramatic accent?
Would you rather a rather dull and boring accent?
No, please say it again and then I'll laugh and I'll carry on. Go then, and again.
Most like it's got a crook in it.
That led him into a discussion of how Tyrion would die on the morrow.
He'll weep like a woman and beg for mercy, you'll see.
Did you ever like it?
He cupped her cheek, remembering all the times he'd done this before, all the times he'd slid his hands around her waist, squeezed a small firm breast, stroked her dog cock,
You slut.
Jezebel, you hardly just strumpus. Ah, you shameless pussy. You have no shame at all. Jesus, Lord, save us and preserve
us. I think you should say this bit in the
Irish accent. Well, I've been chewing an awful loud hour to you, man. Can you believe us?
Carrying on. That's staying in. Right, that's a wrap,
guys. Sorry, we're all young.
Next, hurry in line, topic, please, Lucy.
Did you ever know?
Our next podcast was recorded in October of 2014 by the members of the WolfCast crew. It was a discussion about the possible endings of the A Song of Ice and Fire series. It is unclear why this podcast never came to fruition. However, rumors abound that the recording was sabotaged by an infiltrator from the Kraken cast. All that we can do now is sift through the rubble and wonder.
So one of the things I've always wanted from the series is for John to meet Arya again, whether that be sort of just a closure thing or them getting like back together and sort of going and killing people. But I don't think this actually going to happen. And like I think we were talking about earlier how Arya's going to kill Sansa. I mean, do you think they're going to turn in each other? Sort of like the pack sort of disintegrates?
Mm.
See, I always, the reason I think she's going to kill Sansa is I think she's going to agree to kill somebody she doesn't know, and she'll do it without knowing she's killing Sansa. Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, poisoning her food from the kitchens or something like that. Or maybe she agrees to kill Littlefinger and Sansa is collateral damage. I just fancy she, you know, the whole thing about knowing somebody's name, obviously they reinforce that repeatedly. Well, that's why I think she's going to do it, because obviously Sansa's changed names.
That's a good idea.
But I kind of feel like even if she was sent to kill Sansa, she wouldn't do it, because she kind of does her own thing. She's not completely following the orders of the House of Black and White. When she has to kill someone, she has to like spy on them to figure out the best way to kill them. She's not just like given orders to poison that food and that's it.
Yeah, because I think that's how they're going to meet again, or at least how Arya's going to meet them. She's going to be sent to either kill Jon or to kill Sansa, and then she's going to get there and realise who she really is and not be able to go through with it and then join up with them again.
Okay. Mm. Sansa has to go a long way before she's going to be named as a person to be killed, really.
I don't know. It just has to be sort of linked to sort of Aegon or someone. I mean, if they arrange a betrothal between Aegon and Sansa, then she'd become one of the main enemies or one of the main players in the story.
Maybe, yeah.
And then they'll run off, meet Nymeria, and go to meet Jon at the Wall. Okay, that's it. Right, it's the end of story.
Yeah, but you're forgetting Rickon and Bran. Well,
oh, yeah,
you know,
Rickon.
Bran is not coming home. We're pretty sure about that one. But Rickon, he's going to be king of the North, right? Or something. For a little while, at least.
I don't know. I really don't know what I think about Rickon. Maybe they'll try and crown him as king in the North, but something will happen to him before they go through with that plan. That's kind of what I see happening, because I don't think he's going to become a big player or anything. I mean, it could be, but I don't see that happening.
He's going to storm the North with an army of unicorns.
Could be. Yes. Could be.
Rickon will just be feral. I think he was walking too young, and it'll be a morality tale about what happens when someone so young is left to their own devices. Mm. So he might be used as a puppet king, but I think it'll be a disaster because he just won't be himself in a way.
So do you think that he wouldn't be able to, that Davos won't be able to retrieve him from Skargos?
Oh no, I think he'll probably be able to retrieve him from Skargos, but he'll be just some howling wolf baby.
How old is Rickon supposed to be in the books now?
5 or 6, something like that. She was 3 to begin with, so as far as I remember.
And he's been walking fairly continuously for how long?
For 1.5 years, at least.
Yeah, I mean, like, how much do you even know of yourself at the age of 4 to sort of have a personality that stands up to walking? I mean, I think that poor boy's gone, and I think Arya's gone too.
Well, do you not think that he could then end up as, like, the King of Winter or the King Beyond the Wall or some sort of old god sort of style thing?
I'm not sure how he would get to that position. I mean, it would kind of fit, but I'm not sure how he would get there.
And not necessarily that we see it, but sort of just off screen, he sort of runs off and becomes one with his wolf, and we don't really see him. Like Bloodraven, essentially. He goes off and we don't really see him for 100 years. And it's just sort of, that's just, we don't ever find out. We're just left to assume what happens.
I wonder, I mean, maybe the Worlds of Ice and Fire will tell us sort of more about this, but I wonder how far you can just run off and be a sort of wolf child. And has he just gone too far that he'll probably walk and never come back to being a human again? I don't know how it works, but...
Yeah, it doesn't seem like he has any kind of spirit guide like Bran had, which is kind of sucky that Jojen actually didn't actually put any focus on Rickon, who most obviously also is working at the same time as Bran was.
Yeah, true.
Well, it makes me wonder what's the point of having him in the story, because, I don't know, I assume with most writers, they don't put the effort into creating a character that's central to the story that they're not going to do anything with. So,
well,
is he going to end up doing anything, or is he just going to end up being a thing that's there?
I still think that's a point, because even though we know he might be useless as a ruler because he's not really a boy anymore, The other people in the story don't, so he's still a useful totem for the Grand Northern Conspiracy. He's still an important pawn, and he's a boy, like in a way that Sansa's there with her claims, but it's different with Rickon because he's a guy.
Mm.
But it just seems a lot to sort of fit into the whole... We've only got two books left. I mean, how much time spans a book? About 6 months, nine months? Well, Dany was pregnant so in the first one, so a year at most. In 2 years, do you think they could find him, bring him to Winterfell, call him the King in the North, and find out he's a feral child? Or like, where, what point do you think the story will end or cut it off? Or do you think we'll have to just rush? And...
I'm not entirely sure there are only two books left.
Do you not think so? What, in my mind...
Don't open that can of worms.
Okay, so Howland Reed, will he reveal the R plus L equals J, or is the R plus L equals J even a thing, really?
I hope it's not.
Yes and yes.
You don't... What? Tanya, you don't... You hope it's not? Isn't it practically fact by now?
I'm in denial about it. No, it's probably true. I can't, like... I have to admit that it's probably true, but I just... I still hope it isn't.
£100. £100 that is true.
Yeah, I would not bet against that. But I just wonder if it's not.
I'd love to see it be not true just for the batshit reaction of the internet.
I would be so pleased. If it turns out to be...
But Tanya, it's isn't it like you're saying you don't want him to change stuff because of what's being said on forums, but it works in reverse. If he already planned that, and I think he did, it's so obvious, the hints that are dropped, he shouldn't, because everyone knows it, kind of thing.
Yeah, no, I don't. I hope that if he had planned for this to be true from the start, that he goes through with it. I hope he doesn't change this just to spite fans. But I still hope that he just dropped those hints and then hadn't planned on it being true. But I mean... Yeah, like I'm not saying that's very likely. I'm just trying to stay optimistic here.
If R add L equals J is true, how do you think it's going to be revealed in the series? Like, first of all, revealed to the readers. Second of all, revealed to the people of Westeros, because we can know these things much earlier. Like for example, Bran could reveal it through one of his. But the people in Westeros aren't going to know that. So how do you think it's going to be announced to the nation, if at all?
Well, there's only one possibility, and that's Howland Reed.
Yeah.
He's the only person left who knows.
So how do you think he's going to appear in the series? Because there was the... Have you seen the theory on Reddit that he's the High Septon?
Oh, I hate that.
I haven't seen that one. That
what? Someone explain the theory to me.
Oh my god. Well, okay, so... Yeah,
okay, go ahead. So basically, someone pointed out that the physical descriptions of Howland Reed and the new High Septon are pretty similar.
Because they're both
so
short.
The theory is that Howland Reed is the High Sparrow.
This sounds very, very similar to the whole Jane Westerling bullshit theory.
It sounds like Tom Bombadil is Sauron because we've never seen them in the same place, so that's probably true.
I love that one. That makes so much sense.
It explains everything, doesn't it? And we never Bombadil see them in the same place.
You've never seen them in the same room together.
Exactly. So that's true.
It's one of those things that everybody's obsessed with, the idea that he doesn't put a single word out of place that doesn't have hidden meaning, and therefore if two people are vaguely look like each other, turns out they are each other, and it's
But a horse can change colors, and a character can have green eyes one time and blue eyes another.
It's like it's along those lines of Benjen as Dario, because that would be pretty cool for Benjen to be Dario.
I read that somebody debunking that, who pointed out that the two appear in two different places, close enough that Dario would have actually had to have flown on a dragon to get there in time.
Well, maybe he did. Yeah.
So Benjen Dario is the third rider of the dragon.
Yes.
Benjen Dario Euron, because they're all the same character.
Yes, and Tom Bombadil.
And Tom Bombadil.
Is Victarion already dead?
No, he isn't dead.
No, what was it? I swear, I was listening to something, and they were pointing out the fact that in
It's in the Battle of Marine. I mean, we're getting into winter.
No, I don't mean that. Before the end of Dance, somebody was pointing out that at one point in the chapter, you know, when he has his arm all burnt and stuff by Makaro, the viewpoint changes away from Victarion. So they basically lock themselves up in the ship cabin so Makaro can do whatever he does. And then after that, Victarion doesn't have... Victarion doesn't have the chapters in his from his viewpoint.
That would be so sneaky if that were true. That would be awesome.
But I heard that, and then once I heard it, I went back and reread that chapter, and it does totally change viewpoint in the middle of the chapter. So it's not.
I'm going to have to go and read that now.
So it's, you're saying, Victorian's dead, and Makaro reanimated his body.
Yeah, well, that was the theory.
So he's like Beric.
Yeah, exactly. So he's kind of, you know, he's back alive or whatever. He's been reanimated, but he's not strictly speaking himself.
So who controls him? Makaro controls him.
Well, I'm not sure.
No one controls him. He's like Stoneheart.
Yeah, or like Beric was. Nobody controlled Beric, but he wasn't quite human either.
Ah, okay, cool.
Well, maybe, but as long as Victarion marries Daenerys, then it's fine.
Well, neither of them can have kids if one's dead and one's barren. You know the whole you have to go north to go south, all that sort of stuff. Has that all been fulfilled yet?
More or less.
She hasn't been to Shai yet.
No, but she has gone to east to go west.
Well, she's been to Karth. That's not the...
That's still
Yeah, Kevin specifically said she has to go to Shai.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Like, enough already. Let her get to Westeros.
Yeah, sure.
No, I want her to get to Shai. Shai sounds like a really awesome place.
Alex, but I don't think we're going to see that at all this series.
I'm still hoping.
I think that's what the Worlds of Ice and Fire is for, isn't it? Just to take us to these cool places that aren't plot specific.
A huge section about
like Casterly Rock and Ashai and Skagos. Yeah. Well, I hope we go to Skagos, but yeah.
Well, as far as I know, he's going to put a main focus on Westeros, and the rest is going to be sketchy at best with the amount of facts and information. It's supposed to be written from a Westerosi maester's point of view, so not too much can be completely relied upon about the rest of the world.
Indeed.
Well, I thought it was all canon.
It's all canon, but it's like the rest of Song of Ice and Fire that you can choose who to believe, but it's all canon insofar as George has approved everything in it.
Yeah.
Kind of thing. So if there's a deception, it's a George approved deception.
Exactly.
It's a deliberate mischief rather than someone just making shit up randomly.
So that's why you might hear that there's giant lizards roaming about and right outside Shai or something, but probably shouldn't believe that, because if what we hear about Shai is true, then they probably would kill all the lizards just to make sure there's nothing too dangerous other than their dragons and demons.
Yeah, Ashai's not even real.
Yes, it is.
No, it's a lie that the entire world's telling themselves.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. Who's talking about Ashai? People who we can't trust, like Euron Crow's Eye and stuff like that. Will Dany have all her dragons when we're left?
Bloody hope not.
It would be kind of boring, right?
In my mind, the survival of the dragons and the survival of Westeros as the sort of complete Seven Kingdoms are sort of linked. So if there are no dragons, I don't think we can have a Westeros as we've known it. And then also because people think Dany's going to be alive at the end of the series, because if she dies, we've just got these rogue dragons flying around. And I don't really see that being synonymous with a sort of a healthy Westeros anymore. Even a healthy world, surely they're just going to go off and start killing people, and it's going to go back to the old ways where everything just goes to shit.
There's a lot of other people trying to get hold of her dragons, like Euron and Victarion for once, who was it? Marvin the Mage wants something to do with it as well. Not quite sure what he wants, but he's at least going off to try to.
That dude is dodgy, though, isn't he?
Yeah, definitely, but. He's also very interested in the dragons and is on the first ship off. to get them or to talk to Danny at least.
See, I get the impression that all these dragons are going to be dead by the end of the series, either through being killed in combat or killed by walkers, or if, say, for example, someone's warged into them and then they get killed or connections killed, or Bran just takes them down through the force of sort of ice versus fire, and Bran sides with the old side, and just sort of through his warging thing, that's his final big thing, is that he takes down these dragons, not necessarily ensuring that ice win the battle, but ensuring that it's sort of balanced at the end instead of just fire taking over and just destroying the world.
Yeah, that's what I think as well. I don't know if Bran is going to take them down or what's going to happen to them, but I don't think they'll survive the series, because I just think they're not very sustainable. I don't know what kind of setting we'd end up in, whether the dragons would still be alive. I just don't see that happening. And same for Dany. I also don't think Dany is going to survive the series.
Couldn't agree more. I think the moral of the story from, you know, the princess and the queen and the rogue prince is that dragons laying waste is deeply unsustainable as a form of government, and that Targs and Dany are just basically incompatible with a flourishing human society, and that he set up this kind of Mary Sue who went on a quest and we all thought was going to come home and rule and restore peace and harmony, and he's going to show that that was a pathetic, naive, childish hope, and that actually the reality is going to be very different, and that she will be marginalized. And hence, I would be quite interested to see if Aegon were real and therefore there were two dragon riders or three dragon riders and they kind of mutually destroyed each other. It makes the most sense. If Dany's alive and ruling at the end of this, I don't understand how Westeros isn't just a wasteland, a bleak, nihilistic wasteland.
This does bring up a bigger question of what is Lady Stoneheart's role? Is it simply to get revenge on those who have done her family wrong? Is it to destroy the Freys? Is it to murder Cersei? Is it
just to be batshit crazy?
Yeah, and then at the end of that, how is she going to end up dying? Or is she just going to be there forever and then commit suicide? Or
the fact that she doesn't appear in the TV show probably suggests that it's not a very big role in the grand scheme of things.
Let's not think about that.
But that's not necessarily...
I've forgotten that.
Because it's different.
Yeah, first of all,
it's different gives us clues, and we're talking about the end.
But it can still be something important that someone else can take over in the TV show. Like, it can still be something important in the books that she does, but that the Brotherhood Without Banners ends up doing in the show.
Sorry, before we go further, can I call no spoilers on the TV series? Because
it sucks.
Sorry.
I want no spoilers on the TV series because I'm not watching it next week.
No, me neither. I've stopped watching it until...
Oh, sorry. Okay.
And I started to weaken, like, because the hiatus was so long, and think, oh, maybe I will. And then just today there was a tweet from podcast like House Manwoody saying these pictures have caused a lot of controversy.
I didn't look at that one.
And I was like, oh, shit, I'm going to actually have to now start on following stuff, because even like the tweets about potential shit that's going to annoy me.
This is the thing. What I've realized is I've got about 12 podcasts running, which of about four of them are related to this. I'm going to have to stop listening to all of them. And I think there's a good chance I'm going to have to come off the forums completely because the titles,
I'm going to have to come off the forums from a month before the show starts until it's finished, because I was talking to Amin about this. Like, is there a way of blocking, like, you know, they have the whole board index, there's a whole topic section which is the TV show, and I said, is there a way of selecting something that you only see the topics that exclude that, because that would be a really easy way, but he said it's really hard to do.
But surely you should set up the rule that instead of talking about the topic in the headline, just be like TV show spoilers regarding Jon Snow or regarding Arya.
But that's unfair on the majority of people on the forums who actually are watching the show to make them have to do all that bullshit. I think
the podcast is dedicated to the books. It's not dedicated to the show.
Well, it's dedicated to both.
Absolutely.
So...
And their mission is definitely to the books, but you can't deny that their greatest popularity and source of listeners now probably is through the show, so they can't kind of...
I don't know. I mean, it seems like half and half of the people are going to be stopping watching the show.
I don't think it's half and half. I think it'll be a real minority who stop. I think the majority of people... Well, I don't know. Maybe we should put out the poll and find out. I think the majority of people kind of like, well, it's the real world. I just don't have the patience and discipline not to, so...
Or even a poll just asking about censorship. it's like self-censorship just for the sake of people who don't want to be spoiled.
Yeah, I think the easiest way, because it will calm down when the show's finished, like all those new topics. So probably the easiest way is just to sort of avoid it maybe for 3 weeks before while the show's running and 3 weeks after, and then it'll be kind of back to book type stuff as well.
Yeah, that's probably what I'll be doing.
For me, the way I look at it is very much, it's going to be like things will drop into the story. Like, so for instance, anybody listening to this who doesn't watch the TV series will have just gone, wait, what? Lady Stoneheart's not in the TV series. And then that starts you thinking, right? So, because we just dropped that into the conversation without thinking about it. So it's going to be the same for after the next series. So
with all the best will in the world. And it's kind of unfair of those of us who are the minority who are choosing not to watch it to kind of inflict that on everyone else.
No, I absolutely agree. I don't expect other people to change. I'm just a bit sad about the fact that I'm going to, unless the books come very soon, I'm going to have to drop out of a lot of stuff that I enjoy.
Yeah, I agree with you. You know, we can just sit and Skype about cricket, I guess, Kelvin.
I'll join you guys.
Kelvin, I tell you what. You watch Made in Chelsea, and then we can podcast about that.
We'll just make a Made in Chelsea forum.
You could not pay me to watch Made in Chelsea.
Literally, if I said to you, you have to watch the entire Made in Chelsea up to date, if you ticket to the Rugby World Cup final.
That's not fair. He'd probably take back some of the nice things he said about you earlier.
In fact, Imogen, if I get any Rugby World Cup tickets to my work, that we're going to do a podcast, and it's going to be Kelvin talking to us about Made in Chelsea and proving he knows all about it to get
I love this idea.
Just to prove how much I love the rugby, I have the England Rose tattooed on my arm.
Really?
Yeah, so I'm quite obsessed. But simultaneously, I really, really hate reality TV. Oh.
Well, thank you for listening. And even though we're going to cut ourselves a little short here, we hope you enjoyed whatever
we had. We've been going for 3 hours, mate.
Yeah, this is short by Wolf standard. I hope you enjoyed it, even though it's short. And let's have a
it's quite a girly wolf howl today, isn't it? We're missing.
Getting a bit.
Our next podcast was recorded in April of 2015 and would have been a preview for the upcoming Star Wars The Force Awakens. Hosts discuss the recently released teaser trailer. Sadly, the film itself came and went, leaving the preview to be forgotten in the dungeons of archive.org.
Was anyone on the old Star Wars podcast?
I was.
Zach was on it.
Eddie was. Shane, were you on that?
Yeah, I was on one. How many have we done? There's been a couple, man.
Just one, I think.
Okay. So we don't really have to go into our like Star Wars stories if unless anyone has a hankering to tell theirs. No? Okay, cool.
Young watched it, loved it.
Yep.
Awesome. Let's just talk about the trailer. I guess we can talk about high points, and then I guess we'll all have like something that like wasn't our most favorite part of the trailer. But actually, Peter, what was your favorite part of the trailer?
I mean, I don't know if I can like point to one thing that I liked that much.
Are you giving
maybe
it a
tiny shot of the Star Destroyer? Like, first it looks like a pyramid, and then you notice that it's the bridge of the Star Destroyer when it comes in fully into shot. Probably that one, yeah.
Yeah. Actually, I highly recommend that people look up like recordings of the trailer from Star Wars Celebration, because it's insane. Like, listening to that reaction is really, really something.
Yeah, just all the energy in the room, you can feel it, and it's just really exciting as a Star Wars fan.
Yeah. So I guess my favorite part was and if anyone is friends with me on Facebook, you know what I'm going to say. But it's the part where, you know, Luke is going through his monologue about how, like, you know, my father has the Force and I have the Force and my sister has it. And, like, that was always a line that I just loved because it opened this potential that Leia could be this great, you know, person in the Force. And then I kind of really thought that the rest of the trailer, like, focused on Daisy Ridley's character and, like, kind of highlighted, you know, the potential, like, hey, there can be more than one girl, you know, which is going to be really exciting for me. Also, because I think people have speculated on who Gwendolyn Christie is playing, and that seems really, really nifty.
And may I say, it's great that we have a woman as a main character in this, it's great that we have a person of color as a main character in this, but it is also great that we have a stormtrooper, finally, as a main character in this. Stormtroopers have been woefully underrepresented in Star Wars media since the onset, and I'm just happy that it's finally happened.
Yeah, but his only acting cues seem to be, like, panting and sweating.
I think I saw something that's like, somebody get that guy, like, an inhaler.
And seriously.
And angsting.
That's hot on that planet. Can't you tell?
He's actually a stormtrooper then, and not like he isn't doing a disguise thing there.
I think he confirmed that he's a stormtrooper.
I think they confirmed that.
Yeah and JJ hit him afterwards.
Well, you have to tell us something, JJ. Like, come on. I'm still not over the, what was it, like, John Williams or whatever name that they gave Benedict Cumberbatch.
John Harrison.
Yes, that
John Harrison.
Bullshit. Yeah.
Speaking of John Williams, I thought the trailer,
the music
was great, mm-hmm. and combined with the voiceover and then all the new info, I think it all was like just a perfect soup of greatness.
Yeah.
When it first came on, it was like the music like kind of built up slowly, and like you got that vivid red, and I started to get goosebumps, and then by the end, I was a little teary eyed. I wasn't like crying or anything, but it just welled up. I was like, God damn it, they better not fuck this up now.
Matt, what was your favorite part?
Yeah, I'd agree that the music, like, is that like the Tatooine theme or whatever, like, you know, it starts building and you're just like, holy shit, like, you see this little speeder and then like a crashed X-wing and then like the huge fucking Star Destroyer. Oh, so good.
Do you guys know?
And then
how
Han Solo,
I
like, as a money shot.
I didn't even notice the X-wing until like the third or fourth time I watched that.
Yeah,
I was like watching the thing go along, and I saw, oh shit, it's an X-wing, and then like looked up, and it's, oh shit, it's Star Destroyer.
Yeah, you think it's like another Dune or something.
Yeah,
or like Peter said, like a
first,
pyramid.
The first part of it's like sandy, so you think it's just part of the hill.
Yeah, it's a really great shot. I think. I mean, who knows like how much of like that kind of thing will be in the movie? Well, this one probably will. That's probably like a transition shot, but. Just because it really fools your eye, because you're like, okay, oh, sand, oh, okay, something's moving, that's what I'm looking at, and then you kind of, like, you don't recognize it until you have this moment of, oh my god, you know, and yeah, it was really, really well done. Who hasn't gone? Sorry, I can't keep track of everyone.
No, I haven't gone.
Eddie,
X-Wings are always cool, but I like the music off, because you think the music's gonna kind of resolve off the X-Wings go, but it just keeps going bigger, like
building
bigger musicness to it. I don't know the word.
Crescendo.
We're nothing if we're
it crescendos up to it, and then it's just like tails off, and then you get the, do you know, actually the Han and Chewie bit, not my favorite part.
What?
I don't know. I don't know why, but first time it's like, oh, like, well, it's cool, but then, huh?
Because Han looks like a grandfather and Chewie hasn't changed.
Yeah, he just looks like he's been bumming around.
Yeah, I didn't care for that part either. I mean, I thought Han's jacket looked kind of weird.
Yeah, I mean, it would have been weirder if they had dressed him up in the same clothes, though, like as like episode four. That probably was my favorite part. I know it's cheesy, but I think that for me, especially on the first watch, it was kind of like all of this magnificent stuff, and just getting that is like, as you say, I think Matt, the money shot at the end. It was like, fuck yeah, I'm hyped with that final moment. And yeah, I know it's kind of weird, and Chewie doesn't, it kind of looks too similar, and it's kind of just a weird kind of shot. But yeah, I still thought that was my favorite part.
I thought Chewie's eyes looked weird. Bothered me, huh? He had allergies or something.
Well, Pete Mayhew can hardly walk anymore.
Yeah, I think I just liked the part where he was like, Chewie, we're home, and it's just like because the whole trailer was like back at home Star Wars-y kind of thing, that's why it kind of struck a note. But it wasn't for the Han Solo Chewie thing. It was just, we're home. It's like, yeah, that's right. Let's do it right this time.
Yeah.
Right. Practical effects.
Any speculation on what he means by we're home?
I think he just means the Millennium Falcon. I can't imagine it's anything else.
It sort of feels like they've come back there after a long time away.
Yeah, I would assume that has something to do with it, that he was not in possession of the Falcon for some time.
Fucking Lando.
Stole it after.
Actually, never got it back. Yeah. Perhaps it's just that he's never going to have Lando back, and there's just going to be like a stray cape somewhere, and they're not going to address it.
No, Leia got in the divorce. That's who's had it.
Oh, boy.
Well, no, I especially like the Han Solo end because I think I read somewhere like maybe a year or two ago where he's like, yeah, I'll do another Star Wars movie as a corpse. So the fact that like he's alive in this and doing something is
just fantastic. Did anybody else see the Jimmy Kimmel where he was on there?
No.
No.
He did a thing. He's like, okay, so no Star Wars questions. And they have like a dude stand up like wearing full Leia garb, and he's like, so do you like food? And then at the end, Chewbacca stands up and he's like, oh, how did you got a lot of nerve showing your face here? It's like, she was my wife.
I didn't see that.
Well, yeah, I think he's always been the one who's been kind of the most resentful of being like only identified by that, I guess, that and Indiana Jones. Andy. Yeah.
Yes, poor Harrison Ford, two major cultural landmark franchises.
But I think he's a billionaire
because he's in Blade Runner as well.
Right.
He's jaded because he had a great career.
Yeah. I think he's not as bad as some people think, though. I think that if it had been, there wouldn't have been. Maybe they're just paying him shitload of money. I don't know. But I think that there would have been something that would have made this whole thing more difficult in making it happen if he'd really just hated it.
Yeah. I mean,
I remember, like, hearing that even back when they were doing Return of the Jedi, that Harrison Ford wanted Lucas to write Han Solo to die in that one, so it would make more of an impactful moment, I suppose.
Because he's like,
want the character to go on.
Because it was like, oh, the ending is awful, like, you know, the Care Bears have their picnic or whatever.
Yeah, but his character arc had kind of run its course through the first two movies. He went from being a selfish scoundrel to, you know, someone who was willing to sacrifice for the greater good.
I could see the perfect scene, like Chewbacca cradling him and giving off like a mournful howl. That would have been good.
Instead of getting hit by a fucking moon, yeah.
Well, that's gone. That didn't happen. Never happened.
Thank fuck.
Did that happen in the EU?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. You guys are going to have to let me know when you tell me.
In the what?
In the EU.
Expanded universe.
Expanded? All right.
See, that much I know.
Yeah,
they're calling it like Legends now or something like that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think most people will agree. Successful trailer. Peter notwithstanding. I will say it was funny though, like seeing that final shot, because like for me, I got people have like screen capped that and were using it as the picture like on the articles, so it got spoiled. But I had this moment of dissonance because like everything else really does look the same. Like Chewie looks the same, like the background of the Falcon kind of looks the same, and then it's old Han Solo. It's like, wait, what's going on? But yeah, least favorite moment. Anyone want to go first?
Peter, knock it out.
Yeah, I don't have any. I really don't have any.
I don't know. I'm not super fond of the Stormtrooper sort of redesign. Like, they look sort of too clean and too sort of smooth. There's not enough black, like, thingamabobs on the helmets.
Yeah, but the original ones, they look like plastic.
What kind of cooler looking these ones look like? I don't know. And the character that people have been speculating is Gwendolyn Christie, the sort of silver stormtrooper with the cape. I'm not super fond of that character design either, because in a lot of Star Wars games, they have this, like, they can't come up with anything original, so all they do is, like, come up with new types of stormtrooper and throw at you. So it's the lava troopers and magma troopers and fire troopers and forest troopers, swamp troopers, aqua troopers, whatever.
Wait,
and
they have lava and magma troopers?
I'm pretty sure they do.
Dude, Anakin could have totally used some of that armor.
He was going to bring it along, but you know what? It was just too heavy. And Padme was like, come on, we need to go. Stop packing. And yeah, damn it.
His armor must have been fairly fire resistant if some of it still made it through.
Yeah, I was kind of concerned about that semi-melted helmet. It's like, no, that thing was fully on fire. Like,
how well, apparently, so there's like this joke picture that it's that since Endor fires can't melt Durasteel, that there's like the Death Star is an inside job.
Type. Oh, Jesus.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, I mean, I think that was a little, like, disconcerting because, you know, it's not a scene that really, like, for me, that storyline ends when Vader dies on the Death Star, you know, and then Luke burning his body is kind of just an afterthought to that. So I had to, like, remind myself that that was what happened and that this wasn't, like, some piece of thing that had somehow randomly survived a space explosion. But, I mean, for me, I think the lighting looked a little, I mean, and this is not, like, a major critique. It just looked a little bit more like Abrams' Star Trek movies, like, going over the stormtroopers and stuff like that. But I mean, it's not anything I'm like concerned about. I was just like, okay, like it was an interesting combination of the old stuff and the new stuff, you know? So it.
Right. It was tying over the voiceover.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I think like they're going to, I mean, obviously I don't know what they're going to do, but I think this one will probably pull a lot of like the nostalgia strings on its way to telling the beginning of the story. So people will go home like, oh man, that was great. And then the next two will probably pull away from that more. Well, that's what I think anyway.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how they manage that because there is a worry that they're going to get too fan service-y with some stuff. But I think that with the first Star Trek movie, J.J. Abrams did a really good job of not overdoing it with that, especially with the way he did Spock. I thought that was a pretty effective way of doing that.
Yeah, agreed. And I mean, I'm not really concerned about too much. What can you do that's too much fan service? You know, they've established like at least three major characters, plus at least two potential bad guys, and then maybe more, and whoever that person is with the broad saber and whatever's going on with that. So, you know, I've heard people say, and I tend to agree that the whole Luke, Han, Leia will probably not survive. Like certainly the trilogy and maybe even the first movie.
Yeah, I think that they're
talking about rumors.
Oh, this is just like not like plot, just like not based on like exactly just like, oh, it would make sense in this movie, not like, oh, I heard on Reddit that, you know, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, I have no idea what they're going to do. Like, I haven't heard really any of the rumors for the most part. But I think that it very much, and this is the sense I was getting from the trailer, is that it will be kind of like a passing the torch kind of thing. It'll be in the early part of the movie. And for the most part, they aren't going to be a big factor.
Yeah, I hope so, too. The first
the passing the lightsaber. Sorry.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. And that literally happens. So yeah.
Yeah. And you see him,
that was Luke's lightsaber from Empire Strikes Back.
How do you people know this stuff?
Which is actually Anakin.
How do you recognize it? It's a silver bar.
This is a very iconic.
They recognize the differences between the silhouettes of a lightsaber. Come on.
But the Empire Strikes Back one, he cut off his hand and it fell down the tube.
No, they found it. They found it.
Where the fuck did they find it?
Lando found it.
Be there opening night. Find out.
All right. Come join us on the Vassals of Kingsgrave. Well, the podcast of Ice and Fire forums. We are down at the bottom under Vassals of Kingsgrave, and you know we keep going and going.
Don't have to say it like that.
What?
We yeah, are. Seriously.
And, like we're above certain hidden forums that
we're bottom feeders.
In, but you know.
But you are a shellfish.
Exactly.
Touche.
And what else was I going to say? Oh, yes, we are not award winning, alas.
Award nominated.
Award nominated, yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Feels good.
Yeah. I am pretty proud of that.
Did y'all see that third place?
We didn't lose to, what's his
Cereal?
Name? Cereal.
No.
Yeah, we lost to Bob Has a Podcast, or Podcast, whatever it was.
Something stupid like that.
Hey, but we didn't lose to Cereal.
No, we didn't lose to Cereal.
I'm pretty sure us and Cereal just split the votes. That was the problem.
Yeah.
That's yeah. It. We have all the same listeners. That's the issue.
Yes. All the major news outlets are tuned into us.
We're under the radar, but we're there.
Guys, we have reinvigorated podcasting single-handedly. We invented the genre.
No, voice
no, I think we there's some way we can monetize this.
Thank you, everyone, and may the force be with you.
Force
something,
be with you.
Something dark side. Is that the response? I can't remember. I'm just tired.
That's just legends.
Go to bed.
Yeah, go back to bed.
I think I'll go around now. Bye-bye.
Oh, my goodness.
He was pretty quiet through the whole end. I think he was, like, fighting it.
I feel really bad.
He may have been asleep the entire time.
Fucking Brown Squad. They just always just fall away.
Oh, God, Brown Squad.
It's not very sexy, is it?
Not really. No, but those guys always die anyway, so I don't like.
If you want sexy, I do this whole podcast in a towel.
Oh!
Yeah.
Birthday. It's your birthday. So.
Brown chicken, brown cow.
I still don't know what that
is. That's the best brown chicken, brown cow I ever heard, I think.
Do you live on a farm? I don't
know.
No. The porno music.
Oh!
Brown chicken, brown cow.
Okay. I learn something new every podcast.
Yeah. I'm from Vermont, but I don't live on a farm. Sorry.
Well, you just have like ice cream and artist colonies up there, right? So
we have ice cream? Oh, Apple Ben and Jerry's. All right. Yeah.
Are you really from Vermont?
Yeah.
All right. So
is it pretty up there?
Yankees or Red
Sox? Not right now.
Oh.
I'm not a baseball fan. Get out of here. makes me yawn and go to sleep. My dad loves baseball, though. My brother's a Mets fan.
Yes!
My wife's a Cubs fan, but I agree it's boring.
Ugh. It's okay. Huh? It's something for everybody.
No, that's with the balls and the points, right?
That's most American
sports. They're called runs.
It's points. Only boring if you actually watch it. Like,
okay,
I had
then.
A great weekend just listening to the baseball game and reading a book, and it was fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like you didn't listen to the baseball game, dude.
See, I can't multitask. I don't do that thing where I'm watching TV and playing a game on my iPad and doing this. I gotta do one thing.
So I've been shooting honey badgers this whole time.
With a harpoon gun, right?
Honey badgers are pretty tough. You gotta be careful.
They don't give a shit.
Honey badgers don't care.
Oh my god. Selfish, could you create like a fake account on the forums and just do Honey Badger and just pop in and say random things?
What? Like the account of a Honey Badger on the forum? I don't quite understand.
channel your Peterness. Into this.
That sounds sexual.
No, it didn't. That's what she
said. Brown chicken, brown cow.
That's so much funnier once you understand what you're saying.
You live on a farm? Why are you showering with animals? Because the animals need to get clean too.
There's only like six showers in Vermont, okay?
And I'm lucky enough to have one of them right here on the farm.
We're all just going crazy, and Peter's just listening to us watching the sunrise and like
shooting hunting badgers.
is it the sun season or the dark season, Peter?
The day star hides his face.
What?
The wolf god has swallowed the sun.
Things are different over there, man. It's weird.
Oh, boy.
You know how glad I am that the OK is, like, international? It makes me so happy.
Yes. This is an exotic lifestyle.
Otherwise, Peter would be podcasting with himself.
Gold.
That was just stupid, man.
What's going on? Oh my goodness.
You guys are the worst.
All right.
Thanks for geeking out about Star Wars, guys.
Yeah. Happy birthday.
And, yeah, thanks for the happy birthday. I just realized what you said.
Adult thing, I don't understand. Is this like an inside joke to something? I don't.
It was a book club thing, Greg.
Oh, you're one of those readers, are you?
Wait, tell me how you found the podcast of Ice and Fire again.
So I don't know better.
Oh, look, a skull. I click on that.
You know me so well.
Peter, let's talk about narwhals.
I think it's narwhal, like a wall, not a whale.
Narwhal?
Yes.
Right. At the end. Funnily enough, there's two E's in Wookiee, though. Most people get this wrong.
No, there isn't.
What?
Yeah, but you can't spell Wikipedia.
Oh, Christ.
And really? What does Wookiee mean, exactly? The people of the trees. Come on, this, you should know this shit.
No, I don't have to know this shit. I've been away.
Exactly.
How do you think Han Solo understands what Chewbacca is saying?
If anybody can understand it.
Because he understands Wookiee.
It's a different language.
Yeah, but I mean...
just can't speak it.
My dog does shit all the time. I don't know what the fuck she's talking about.
Well, you don't understand dog.
I feel like I've been with my dog almost as long as... Hansel's
he understands it the same way Luke understands R2.
Apparently not.
Well, to be fair, the stakes are a lot higher for Han understanding Chewie.
Maybe vice versa.
Right.
Yeah, like Han's the main because pilot. When Chewie needs to take a shit, that's going to be a big thing.
You know what someone should do?
You're going to have
someone
to get,
should, like put subtitles for Chewie's dialogue. Like, if he was actually speaking, that would totally change everything.
Wouldn't that kind of be like Vader speak, like having an inner monologue, though? I'm not for that.
What are these assholes doing? I said I was thirsty.
Han has no idea what he's saying.
Take the pie out of the oven. Somebody must have done that.
Like, please, someone take me home, please.
Chewie's the one that keeps breaking the hyperdrive. It's like, no, we're not going there.
Yeah. Well, I think they actually had the actor like say some lines like I've seen some when they were actually shooting the scenes like in the control room. He's like, that old man is mad talking about Ben or something like that. But I don't know if all his lines had sort of lines about them.
Have y'all heard Darth Vader like when they feel like David Prowse's voice?
Oh, that's my God. Hilarious. The Englishman?
Yeah. Ew.
Sounds like Dark Helmet.
Come on, now tear this place apart until you find those plans.
I wasn't playing with my dolls.
Our next clip also comes from April of 2015 and was a review of the recently released film Mockingjay Part 1. But this proved to be a vengeful month for the Darkling plane, and it claimed all but 6 minutes of audio for its sacrifice.
Yeah, I read the Hunger Games, like, God, it was like a long time ago, like way before I think even the movies were even a thought. Maybe they were, I just didn't hear about it until much later, but yeah, I've been a fan for a long time of the Hunger Games book, so I've been obviously eagerly awaiting every movie release, going out to see them as well.
I would say the same. So I did read them in 2010, all three of them, and around that time, I think that was when they were doing development work on the movie. They were still casting.
Right. I think that's probably about right for me, too.
That's right. At that point, they had got the movie rights, so Lionsgate had the movie rights to the novels at that point, but they didn't really... he hadn't casted yet, or he didn't really have much in mind of what to do with the movie series. Yeah. So it's surprising how well it's turned out.
Yeah, I was definitely pleasantly surprised. There is kind of the stigma with this sort of like book to movie adaptation thing, especially these sort of young adult books, that you worry that it's going to go pretty poorly and it's going to be more of a cash grab than anything. But I think that for the most part, they've done a really good job.
When I was starting the forum, trying to gather interest for the topic to see if anyone would join. I think it was Greg mentioned after they do Mockingjay Part 2 that they're planning on doing more movies. Is that right? I haven't heard
I think he mentioned that, but that baffles me, right? Like, I mean, they can't possibly have enough material in the book itself to sustain that, so I guess they're going to make up their own stuff, right?
And even if they do that, I can't imagine the cast would return for that.
Yeah, I don't know, like, with the contract situations and stuff, but yeah, I think that I think it must be pretty, for one, exhausting to make these big budget movies so many and to be tethered to them for so long. And there is a genuine concern that your reputation could be put at risk if they're not going to take it too seriously with whatever new stuff they churn out.
Yeah, because I can imagine maybe they would do it, but it would be maybe more budget, and they would hire different actors and have a different story to it.
Yeah, maybe. That just seems like such a risk.
I know, it's weird.
Yeah. It's tricky because I think if the franchise looked like it was on the up and up, maybe it'd be possible. But I think that from what I'm seeing from like critical reviews and box office numbers, I think it's actually kind of losing steam a bit. So I worry that they might be, you know, kind of overextending a bit with that.
That's right. I think it's similar to the Harry Potter movies. So they started off around the $300 million gross in America, then like $1 billion worldwide, but then eventually they've lost steam. But then actually eventually it got to Goblet of Fire, which then was more successful than all others.
Yeah, I think there was kind of an upturn with that one, whereas I'm pretty sure it's been mostly... Well, I think Catching Fire was bigger than Hunger Games, but I think they kind of lost a bit on this last one, right?
That's right. Well, speaking of the box office, it has been a good record so far for the movies. So the Hunger Games, that was number two in the box office against... The Avengers, number two of 2012. Then
hard to beat that one.
And 617 million or something. Then Catching Fire, that was number one of the box office in 2013. Then I think Mockingjay almost was number one, but then it was beat by American Sniper.
Ah, okay.
Julianne Moore doesn't really give a villainous presence in the movie. I don't know if you agree or not. From what we've
seen
part one.
Yeah, I don't know. It's kind of a tricky thing because her role is kind of muted. It's not really doing much, but I thought she was fine.
Oh, yeah, she was great. It's very subdued, but I'm sure she'll be more of a nasty villain in the second movie.
Yeah, she'll have a lot more to play with in that one. I'm looking forward to that.
I think they could have maybe played it up more with when Katniss is making demands and she wants for Peeta to have immunity. So at that point in the book, we knew this woman's a bitch in the book because of, she wanted to rescue Peeta, not Katniss, that she had a thing against Katniss. And she wanted Peeta and Inaboria to be made an example at that point in the book. So that's why we knew that...
She's definitely ruthless. That's right, I think that was translated fairly well.
Maybe it's just because they've still got screen time for Donald Sutherland, so President Snow is still there in the background, that maybe he's stealing some of the attention away from President Point.
Yeah, I guess so. I think that when she's sort of in the power position, that's when we're really going to get to see her, like, the full evil, I guess, of President Point manifest.
So I feel also Katniss and Gale could have had a few more discussions about District 13. Which was missing from the movie, and how District 13 isn't really that much better than the capital.
Yeah, I think that that's kind of an important setup. Maybe not necessary, but yeah, I remember them like doing some stuff about that. Maybe not like the full on like full evidence of the rationing and the sort of controlling of the lives, but I thought they did a decent job of at least visually portraying sort of the, I don't know, military kind of like controlling conditions of the place.
Oh, and they did mention that District 13 were happy to have District 12 because something about the genetics,
yeah, the whole breeding issue.
Breeding, that's it.
Because they had some kind of disease that wiped out their population, right? Yeah. That's definitely a little creepy.
Our next podcast comes from June of 2015. It is the WolfCast's unreleased review of Game of Thrones' Season 5 finale. This audio contains spoilers for the show, and some listeners may prefer to skip ahead 16 minutes to avoid it. You have been warned.
I kind of spotted a bit of a theme throughout the episode, and I guess it's a theme throughout
whole series, of the idea of characters kind of realizing that they're not who they thought they were or who they wanted to be. So Stannis's arc of not quite being like, he wants to be a good father and a man driven by his destiny, whereas actually he kind of realizes towards the end he's driven by his pride. Aya wanting to be this kind of cold-hearted assassin, but she's still a kind of little girl inside. That sort of thing. There are kind of a few other examples which I wrote down. Brienne thinking that she's kind of driven by this honour and obeying her promise to Kat, and actually she then leaves that, leaves Sansa to go and kill Stannis, being motivated by revenge, and Dany kind of realising that she's not as powerful as she thinks she is. That sort of idea.
That's a really good point. I like it. I was looking for a general theme other than decapitations and rape. yeah, I like this better, I have to say.
I never thought of it before, but I think you do have a good point there, that I guess that can be applied to a lot of the characters. So you were saying Arya, maybe Cersei as well.
Yeah. The schemer... finding out that she has been
Has a heart and
oh yeah,
maybe not a heart but
maybe yeah, I don't know. I've very conflicting feelings about I've had this whole race about Cersei. She's I can see her motivations clearly for me, so that's why when I can understand a person, I naturally have more empathy for them, I guess. But yeah, I think that Cersei for me is like she thought she would be this master schemer and get rid of everything, and she found out that she was actually being schemed herself, and was just as much put in the situation she wanted other people to be. I just have to ask, why is it that every time somebody betrays a person, it always has to be daggers? Why can't it be swords? Why can't it be spears? It's always like
one of
daggers.
Them did have a fairly long sword.
Who?
I don't know who. One of the stabbers had definitely went right through him.
No, I'm pretty sure it was just long daggers.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, I mean, it certainly wasn't like a broadsword. Might have been a longish dagger. But
I mean, another way to kill John, which is been to chop off his head right then and there, just like, hey John, look over here. What? Chop.
Yeah. It would be much less cinematic.
I know.
Well, if you remember last episode, an innocent young girl was burned at the stake, so I would class that as a betrayal.
that's true.
Oh yeah, okay. You're right, there might be construed as a betrayal if you really work hard at it.
The Red Wedding is definitely a betrayal. That was supposed to be a crossbow-based betrayal.
That's a different thing. I mean, when you think of through history and through most of the book, through many books, it's almost always daggers are sort of associated with the... like sneak attacks, and you know, you have also like Julius Caesar, whereas like all the different senators.
All of the senators had come in with kind of whacking great broadswords, that would have been quite obvious.
Yeah, but in
would have been here would have worked, but
yeah, it could have worked here. It's just,
in a lot of situations, daggers are just, it's quite difficult to do a sneak attack with something that's not sneaky.
Maybe it's just a trope that I noticed.
No, I mean, it's definitely a trope, because it's definitely, you know, deliberately the Ides of March, isn't it? March. I can't even say it properly now. I'm so used to saying the Ides of March. Whatever.
Other than that, why did they specifically put up a piece of wood with traitor on it? Seems a bit weird. Staged? What if some person that wasn't in LA came by and like, what are you guys doing? We just really don't like this piece of wood, so
it betrayed us.
Yes, we're making an example.
You show that wood.
Yeah, bad wood.
Wood.
Yeah. So, and then he gets stabbed, and Allison actually not only betrayed John, but he also sort of betrayed us, because a lot of us thought that Alistair would actually have been the one that would refrain from doing this underhanded things. But
yeah, because as we said last episode, he's an honourable dick.
Yeah, but he's apparently not that honourable.
No, well, again, it's like the... I think I said last episode, it's the show trying to play, you know, Alistair is not the droid you're looking for, Yuka. He is absolutely not, definitely not going to stab John. He's not going to do it. Ha, look, he did it. And it's... It's not like it didn't make character sense. Although, why the hell did he let them through the wall?
Yeah.
It's designed to keep them out. If you just didn't open the gate, you'd be fine.
Yeah, and be like, so what are you going to do about it? You're just going to freeze to death, essentially.
Yeah. I guess that would have involved everyone in the watch being on John's side. Sam or someone might have gone down there and opened the gate, and then it'd be slaughter. And then there'd be no one there to watch, just John, King of the Wildlings.
Mm.
And he'd be king on the wall, and he'd become the Night's King. Hooray!
Full circle.
Yay, and that's just the end.
Yeah. How it should have ended. And Ollie, yeah. It's so obvious, but this is like a complete reference to the Julius Caesar scene, right? That this specific person that has gained the trust of the person that's getting killed, and he's one of the last people to stab for dramatic effect.
Yeah, I mean, if you were really going for the Et tu, Brute, you'd have gone for Ed, which wouldn't have made any character sense. But...
No. But Et tu, Ollie is still fine, especially after that much screen time he's gotten after this whole season.
Yeah, I think they could have handled Ollie a little better. Like, people I know who are just show watchers didn't trust him going into the episode.
No.
And you could set him up... it's a very delicate thing to do, but just a little bit more subtly.
Yeah.
So, like, he's clearly still a bit broody, but he's not, you know, going to Sam and Sam telling him, sometimes you have to do hard things for the watch, sort of thing.
Mm.
There was two things that I was going to say. The first thing was they did a very similar scene, so a Julius Caesar type scene in the Prince Caspian movie as well. Prince Caspian's uncle. But the second thing I was going to say is, did anyone ever go on a website called jumptheshark.com? I used to spend a lot of time on that and reading about like movies, TV shows and stuff, and it just talked about various tropes and stuff. But there's one that's really popular called the Scrappy-Doo of the show, which is like this new character that comes in, and it's typically a younger character to, you know, bring in younger audiences, and it's typically the character that wrecks the show, and I think that Ollie is that character.
Well, yeah, he didn't specifically add to that plotline.
Could be replaced with any other existing character. I just don't understand why he suddenly comes in. Kills you.
I mean, you wouldn't even need him to be in the show at all. You could just have a bit more of Alistair Thorne being a dick, a bit more, I don't know, just less wall and more character development in Dawn or something, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. They essentially just expanded on this Saturn character, which Saturn was totally cool. That guy is, that boy was one of the gay characters in the books that a lot of people thought was pretty awesome because he was good with the bow.
But, I'm quiet because Saturn's one of the, you know, there aren't a huge number of characters on the kind of LGBT genre, and he's kind of on the trans spectrum as well. Like, he's very feminine in his homosexuality, which no one else on the show is, right?
No, yes, exactly. He grew up in a whorehouse, and he's not been raised in a patriarchal society as all the other gay people have been.
Yeah, I mean, the show's done an okay job representing their gay character, but I just think, you know, to me, the more the merrier, basically, because there aren't enough on TV. But, you know, not every show can be like Orange is the New Black or whatever, right? But, yeah, I think it would have been an interesting character, and I think he's a character that means something to John. Like, I just didn't believe there was any relationship between John and Ollie other than John wanting Ollie to do one thing and Ollie being a teenager and not wanting to do what his father figure tells him to do.
John is going to at least be dead until, what do you think, first episode next season? Or are they going to
draw it out? There's a lot of press at the moment, quite bold statements that are released just now. I mean, I've seen one that it was in the Mirror newspaper, Kit Harington sacked from the show and things like that. And they're trying to paint it out that he's not coming back in any form whatsoever. But of course, no one believes that.
No, I think we kind of touched on it earlier, right? This idea that we kind of assume John is coming back. The reasons behind that are we kind of think he's, if not as Azorahai, something very kind of significant, right, story-wise.
Yeah.
And because he says ghost, which you could say anyway. So, I mean, it wouldn't be, they're obviously going to say he's out, and I'm sure he is coming back, but it wouldn't be extraordinary for them to not bring him back in the books or the show. Like, I'm sure they will in both, but it wouldn't be kind of...
Exactly.
There was an interesting thing.
After so much build-up of his storyline, to just end it at that, including the books as well, to end it at that point.
Yeah.
But I don't know, I think you can... There would be ways to do it, I think.
After the Red Wedding happened, and David and Dan said that Catelyn definitely won't be back, Lady Stoneheart, that won't happen in the TV show, I sort of didn't believe it at the time. But then that's sort of true, that she's not been back, they haven't made any reference to it. And then they're sort of following the same path with John, that they're sending the same sort of press releases about John's character. So maybe that gives it some credence that maybe he won't be back.
I guess it depends how much they make the show for book readers, right? So we kind of, if you don't bring back Lady Stoneheart... and then say you're not going to bring back John, we're more likely to believe that as a book reader, given that we know they already haven't brought back Lady Stoneheart. So,
yeah. I don't know. Judging from the depth of the storylines and the show, I don't think that that's a thing that David and Dan thinks about that much.
No. Which I think is fair enough. You know, the vast majority of people who watch it aren't going to have read the books.
Yeah. It's not like there's any other drop plot lines like that, right?
Oh dear.
I mean, it's just going to go the way of Gendry.
Yeah, well that's true. Oh, well, I mean, I still think Gendry's coming back.
Really?
I mean, he has to. One of my favourite crackpot theories I've seen is that Gendry isn't Robert's bastard. Gendry is the true-born son of Robert and Cersei. And Cersei gave him up at birth because she didn't want to admit that. Which I think is just an amazing theory.
I've read that theory myself.
but
how does it make sense?
Oh, it doesn't. It doesn't make any sense.
It doesn't. It just shows that when Cersei says that she was pregnant with Robert's child, that she aborted it, but then she just told Ned Stark that, but she didn't actually abort the child. She kept it and then, I guess, left it on her doorstep or something.
And then the workaround... I think there's a line from Gendry where he kind of says, you know, my mother was a tall, blonde woman or something. And there aren't that many blonde people in Game of Song of Ice and Fire. But then you have to work around the whole Cersei will have three children prophecy. And the workaround for that is you'll have three, Robert will have 30, but that doesn't include the one you both have, which I think is brilliant.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, it might turn out to be true, but it's pretty unlikely.
It's pretty shoehorned in there.
Oh, definitely. I'd like to see more Gendry. I really like the actor. I don't know if you in Denmark got Skins.
I watched most of it.
It got progressively worse, but there are some really good actors in there.
At the end where one of them died.
Yes, yeah.
That's the series I watched, so I didn't watch season one and two of Skins.
Yeah, so...
three to five, I think.
Yeah,
so I didn't watch five and six, because they did like a new generation each couple of years. But, yeah... From season one, there's like Nicholas Holt, who's Beast in the X-Men prequels, and then there's what's her name? oh my god, I can't remember, Sam's woman in Game of Thrones, Gilly. Gilly was in it, as was Gendry.
It's just
Hannah Murray, that's her name. Well done. I've never got that. So yeah, there's kind of
a lot of sort of up and coming actors that have been in Skins. So there's Effie, she was she's in the Maze Runner movie.
She was in the movie.
Kaya Scolderio or something.
yes, an unpronounceable name.
Yes. Dakota Blue Richards, who was in The Golden Compass, and she went on to Skins later. Well, after The Golden Compass, anyway.
There was, I don't know if it's a kind of British film, I think it didn't really get well released, called Start Up, which is kind of about this kind of, like,
youth. I have that on DVD.
Yeah, and that's got Jack O'Connell in it, who was in Skins, and he is just incredible in that film. He really is. So yeah, they're kind of always British actors. We're quite good at exporting our actors.
Yeah. I know I have a low-budget Irish film called The Voice in Jack, where essentially all the actors from Harry Potter are in as well, just with different roles.
As in all of the young actors in Harry Potter?
No. All of the, Lucius Malfoy and Lupin and somebody else.
There's a brilliant interview with Mark Freeman, as in The Hobbit. We talk about the Hobbit role. It's like, what makes you most happy about this? It's like, it's great because I'm the only British actor who hasn't been in Harry Potter, so I've managed to one up them being in Hobbit. It's kind of true, but just.
This next segment comes from the SeattleMoot Meetup, held in November of 2015. In which the attendees Skype called other members of the podcast to share in their celebrations.
Hello?
Oh, is that the cookie tin?
FT Ward?
Yes.
So Amber and I are together in Seattle and we just thought we'd like drunk dial everyone.
She means Vina. Amber and Vina. You might not have known from the accent.
I figured it out.
How are you doing, D?
I'm well. How are you guys? Sounds like you are well.
I'm well.
We are well.
Well.
Very well.
I'm only okay.
Oh, no.
Go Royals.
Fuck you.
Yay. Really?
Well, I thought she was kind of petty on Twitter, so.
I was kind of petty on Twitter. And still fuck you.
I feel all of you collectively have not given Shane enough of a hard time that Dallas Cowboys lost.
Oh, I don't pay attention to football, so somebody else is going to have to take up that one.
Yeah.
If anybody was going to give him shit, it should be me, and the Seahawks did so. I mean, it was purely, we won that game based on weird calls. Like, nobody won that game.
Win is a win.
I mean, I'll take it. I'm happy, but.
My team scored 49 points and didn't win. I have not a leg to stand on.
Who's your team?
New York Giants.
Yeah.
And who are you playing?
New Orleans. We're playing the Saints. Yeah. And it was just a shootout.
That's terrible. We were. That's at least exciting. 12-13 is like a nail-biting nightmare. Like nothing was really happening, but I was anxious the whole time.
Ugh. Russell Wilson can't find Jimmy Graham for shit. And...
No. But they're not so handsome.
You sound like my mom when she's not handsome.
No, but I do that too. Like when I'm at a Mets game and they like show the players' pictures. Like I know what all the Mets look like, but I like on the other team, I'm always like commenting with my sister, like, "Oh, that guy's cute. Oh, that guy looks like a villain. Oh, that guy, you know, whatever." I'm like, I still care about the game and I'm intelligently watching the game, but I sound like, you know, I just care about what they look like.
That was my whole strategy in the Rugby World Cup. As soon as England were knocked out, everyone in England was like, oh, well, now you have to support one of the other home nations, like Scotland or Ireland. I was like, screw that. The cat buckle. Captain of New Zealand All Blacks is like really hot and he's single. So yeah, go with the All Blacks. So that was it, really. And my Australian best friend wasn't amused, but you know, there you go. It was incontrovertible logic.
I agree.
Yeah.
But we figured out, Matt, how to get him back in the podcast. Like, given that your plea evidently made no difference.
Yeah, I'm used to it.
And that was, you know, he has
people ignore me all the time.
Oh. You know how he has this whole fantasy about Carl rescuing him from the bear with the gun in the Ziploc bag?
Say what?
You know, that old nugget. But that's widely known, right? I mean, that is known in Game of Thrones parlance.
Who is rescuing who?
Peter is being rescued by Kyle.
Oh, Kyle.
Carl uses a gun that he takes from a Ziploc bag and shoots the bear. Yeah. I feel this isn't news.
Was that in the dreams forum?
Yeah, I had a dream about Kyle like 2 days ago, too.
Really? What was your dream about?
I don't know, he was driving like an RV. I forget. He like left me in a parking lot or something. It was weird.
So he rescues Shellfish, but he abandons everything. What does that mean? That's really... Was there a reason why he abandoned you, or did you just...
There was. I just don't remember now. I should have wrote it down.
It's funny how people seem to dream about Kyle rather than Amin or Ashley when it comes.
Yeah, I would prefer to dream of Ash.
Having met Kyle, he is kind of dreamy.
Wait a minute, where does it get the water from? That kind of seems gross.
There's a band called B-Day Mate.
It doesn't use as a normal bidet would, like proper, like normal fresh water, right?
No, it looks like it's coming like straight from the toilet. Oh no! Well, there are all the attachments to put them in the toilet bowl.
So what do? So you plumb it into the toilet bowl?
Yeah.
It's got a little diagram, doesn't it? Can you attach the little...
I mean, I'm seeing a picture. It has a hose and stuff like that.
Plumbing.
Let's see what the one-star review
attachments. Stuff.
Yeah, what are the reviews like?
Very good. It has 4.5 stars. And, okay, one of them, most helpful positive review, says it's the best seat in the house. Oh, brilliant.
Hey, Matt, did you discover where that, you know, secret love child of yours was from the last podcast?
Which
like,
one?
Like the one that was in his house screaming.
Yeah. No. It was ghosts.
Because that
ghost children?
Yeah.
Oh, well, it's Boston. That's a thing.
That's the thing.
The farther east in the country you get, the more ghosts there are, right?
Is that a thing?
Does only white people have ghosts then?
Yeah.
because y'all have been around more, or because the country's older over there.
Yeah, we kill a lot of Indians, though, on that side.
Woody Indian ghosts.
We put them all in the burial grounds and then build houses over
there. That's it. Actually, we just had, like, Boston goes out for Halloween a lot, especially, like, Salem with the witch trials, like, their whole economy is based on, like, Halloween. Like, the month of October is, like, you know, like, a beach town or something, if they don't make
the
money
like,
then.
That's like a snuff movie, isn't it? Like, who, like, do people literally go to Salem for Halloween? That's just weird.
Oh, yeah. You should see, like, Every shop in there is witch something, like, you know.
How far is that?
It's about 30-minute train and ride.
Oh. I feel a little bit like that way about Jack the Ripper stuff in London. Like, on one level, like, you can see that it's people who are really genuinely interested in it and whatnot. And on the other hand, it's a little bit like, not snuff movies, like, the wrong word, but it's a little bit...
Gross.
It's exploited.
Weird.
I just feel like these, you know, we've talked about this, Thomas, right? Like, you know, these women were victims, and now, like, tourists are standing around, like, handing around, like, autopsy photos of them.
Oh, yeah. No, I feel exactly
the same. It never ends. And I've done it. Like, I'm exactly the person who does that, so I'm not judging others. I mean, I'm judging myself, but it's just weird.
No.
Well, yeah, I mean, Salem really, like, that makes me sad, right? Because that was, like, a lot of people who were, like, murdered for no reason.
People were murdered in Salem.
A lot.
No, it's not that.
I think it's
that
the.
It's like less than a dozen.
Yeah, I think it's.
Okay, but still, that was. Yeah.
Okay, but that's like comparable.
It doesn't.
That's comparable to Jack the Ripper, right?
No. Yeah.
Well, it depends. There's what, 5 known victims of Jack the Ripper?
There are 5 canonical victims.
So. Thomas, how many canonical victims do you think H.H. Holmes had?
It's impossible to tell. I mean,
which, by the way, is a VOK waiting to happen.
Yeah.
Oh, I'd definitely be interested. Didn't he get convicted on 27?
Yeah, I mean, he admitted the stuff that's probably not true, and he lied about stuff that he probably did, so it's...
The thing is, like, people would just disappear in Chicago, period, so it was hard to tell. I mean, you could probably make a decent case for a lot of them who were, like, in his hotel and conveniently never seen again, but, like,
you know. He had to be, like, Magor and kill, like, the builders of his hotel, right?
No, he just, like, fired them all.
He built the thing basically for free because there weren't labor laws, so he would just like make them build it really in really weird slow ways, and then they would be like, "Fuck this, I'm quitting." And he'd be like, "Bye," and hire new laborers and like not pay anybody.
Really? That was actually
how he got caught, because he wouldn't pay for anything. His like creditors were like following him around the country.
They always
get. It was actually only
Mr. Al Capone. Always the money.
Yeah.
The wire. Follow the money, you don't know where it's gonna end. All the
people on the top. Yeah, crazy book.
So, was he being investigated by the Pinkertons? Or?
Yeah, I think someone hired, because he did a lot of insurance fraud, right? Or, well, not insurance, he did insurance fraud too, but I think so.
I think that's how he started off, right? In Texas or something, to the woman, before even moving to Chicago?
Yeah, I don't recall, he started in New York, I thought.
New York, and then he went down to Texas, and then came back, or maybe I'm reversing that.
But what? So where's he from originally? Like, where was he from at the start?
I thought he went to, like, school in New York for some reason.
Yeah, like upstate.
Yeah.
I don't want to say Rochester.
Feel about his life, because he, like, he wrote an autobiography, and, like, a lot of it was ridiculous lies.
Yeah.
But he was a writer, so...
Says New Hampshire is where he was born.
Is he, like, was he the first, like...
27 murders he confessed to.
It's hella murders.
But he was only convicted for the Pitzel murders. That was all he was convicted for. I mean, they still killed him, but...
Sure
what was the deal? Was he just criminally insane, basically?
I just think he had no empathy at all. I mean, he didn't care.
At least the way the Devil in the White City makes it sound, he was, like, textbook psychopath. Like, charming and like really kind of had a fascination with like having people at his mercy and killing them.
Yeah, but then he like disposed of their bodies in like acid and ways.
Yeah, well, he didn't want to get caught. He just wanted to.
Was that more logistical than?
Well, he sold their skeletons then to like medical schools and stuff.
Yeah,
afterwards.
He was very good at making money on top of everything else. Yeah.
Right. It says here he went to University of Michigan for his med degree, and he used to steal cadavers from the laboratory and disfigure the bodies and claim that the victims were killed accidentally in order to collect insurance money.
Yeah.
It happens.
So, because I've only read The Devil in the White City, are there any other, like, really good books to read, or is it, like, the kind of the Uber book?
Yeah, I've read that, and I've watched a couple of documentaries.
Okay.
Ugh, it's so sad, though, because, like, the way he was, like, the way they, like, the kids were alive for a very long time while they were looking for them. It was really awful. Which was one thing I thought the book was a little weird on, because, like, you kind of follow it up to that point, and then, boom, all of a sudden he's in prison, and the detective is, like, hunting, like, trying to follow this trail, and it was like, I feel like we missed a few steps here.
Agree.
It's that guy, like, is he, like, Jack the Ripper of the US? Is he the sort of, like, the archetypal serial, like, one of the...
There's so many.
No.
He's also on the very long list because, to be Jack the Ripper, but he was in the USA when the murders happened, but, like, his name even gets included, like, as a possibility.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he actually passed himself off passed himself off. He, like, lied to some of the women he was entrapping that he was actually English. And because he, you know, Holmes wasn't his real name, so it was like, oh yeah, I'm this aristocrat.
Like the Rockefeller guy in Boston.
Oh, the kind of the fake Rockefeller,
yeah, he's crazy pants.
They have an article on him in Vanity Fair like once every year, practically.
Hmm.
They're obviously fascinated by
him. Gerhard Schneider.
Yeah. But it's kind of weird to me because you read these articles and you think, how could anyone believe that? It's, I think it says more about people who want to believe they've met, like, a sort of American.
Well, yeah, it's about celebrity.
Skill. Yeah, exactly.
Or weird people willing personality. I was going to say, when you said it was really gory, do you guys watch Gotham? This season, I just caught up on it. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
they blew someone up a couple of weeks ago. Like, is it worse than you see the body exploding.
We only have season one so far in the UK. We haven't got season two yet. But is it really grim?
It's terrible.
It's pretty...
He can't believe it.
Are you upset, Matt?
they chopped off a dude's arm and you saw, like, the meat. Like, it wasn't just, like, off camera. It was like you saw the fucking, like, blood coursing through his severed arm. It was like Game of Thrones kind of, like, level.
What time does it air? Like, is that on cable in the US?
It's on, like, yeah.
It's,
seven.
It's on
Fox,
at, like,
isn't it?
Eight.
Yeah, it's on eight. It's ridiculous. I have no idea what tone they're going for. It's, like, part campy, part gory. It's insane.
Right. So it hasn't sorted itself out in a second, though.
No.
No.
Yeah, we watched the first couple episodes and just couldn't stick it out.
Yeah, I don't know why I watch it.
Because it's, I think there's always that residual hope because the characters are so strong that it's dealing with, and you just always...
Right, it's Batman. You know this world.
Yeah, the cast is good, but the writing is horrible, and just the overall direction is a mess.
Well, like Jada right. Pinkett Smith. I mean, the fact so over the survived top. Her is...
I mean... That was pretty gory, but when she ripped out her own eye, like,
yeah.
Season one.
Spoiler alert!
Oh my god.
Yeah, and then they had an eyeball. They were, like, carrying around an eyeball.
What's it called? What was that show? Oh, Alcatraz.
Hmm.
Oh, yeah.
Canceled. And it wasn't that really that good, but it had potential.
No, but that girl rocks some sweaters.
I like the idea, but, and also Carmen Dernagro was in it, and I love her.
I do too.
Speaking of rocking sweaters, so the hilarious thing is, like, I was listening to the Twin Peaks book, and like there was obviously for Cheryl and Fenn in tight sweaters.
Mm.
And then I was watching this, like, as you do when you're on planes, you end up watching shit movies. I was watching this awful, the Brittany Murphy story.
Oh,
Christ,
that was just, like, Jesus.
Shit. So I went from watching, like, Mr. Robot, which is also that, because I'd seen every other movie, that's one I've seen. So, anyway, it stars Sharon and Fenn, but Sharon and Fenn's, like, now, like, older than me and, like, not hot.
She didn't age very well.
She didn't age well at all.
Was she the mom, or?
Yeah, she was the mom. That's sad. It was really sad. Yeah. Time to she was.
Jennifer Lawrence just said something today that, like, She's doing as much work as she can, like, before she gets ugly, basically.
Well, that's fucking...
Aw, Jen.
That's a shit thing to say.
I mean, I think it was... Let me see what she actually said. She said she's aging like a president.
I'm assuming this was, like, self-mocking.
Yeah, for sure. Everything Let's see. What'd she tell people? Let's see what she told people exclusively. No, she didn't. She told press conference. I try to keep working so people can see other characters and other things I can do instead of taking vacation time. And now I'm aging like a president. Oh, okay. I guess she's saying because she works so much that she's, like, not sleeping and stuff.
But, I mean, she's not... I mean, that's, like, that kind of, like, you know, that false modesty kind of... Like, she's not evidently...
Well, looks like shit.
You know.
I don't think saying your life is as stressful as the president is false modesty. It's kind of...
It's hubris.
Yeah.
It's just, I think, here's the article. I'll just link it in.
She can do no wrong in my eyes. She can say whatever she wants.
So I was, like, really callous. Like, Matt wanted to podcast with Mimi on last week. And I, like,
oh, that's right.
I pounced on it.
I'm available.
And then that day she's like, she messaged me on Facebook. She's like, oh, well, I might not be able to do it. And then, like, an hour later, just kidding, I'm going to be able to do it. Oh. I was like,
man. Yeah, but that wasn't the dagger. That wasn't deliberate. What it was, like, I suddenly realized, like, I did the time difference and I realized I would have to, like, step from midnight to podcast.
Did she?
Then I have to be at work the next day, which was stupid.
Did she show up?
So then I, like, was like, oh, Matt, you go ahead, do it. And then I was like, what am I saying? It's Mimi. And I, like, I was deleting the Facebook, and I was like, I'm so mean.
So did she show up?
Yeah, she showed up.
And Thomas, you were on that one, right?
Yes.
Sweet.
Yeah.
But that was a meme. Like, he, like, looked at the thread, and he's like, well, I pick you and you.
Yeah, it looked like. Yeah, but in the world of, like, our forum, we're all, like, really nice. And I knew that Matt was kind of, like, really wanting to do it. Yeah. Like, and I have podcasts, like, I could leave. Being like, ah, oh, you take it.
And she still decided to fuck with me.
Is anyone going to the, I mean, I can't go, so I don't know why I'm asking, but the Ice and Fire Con this year? Next year?
Yeah, I am going.
Tom, aren't you?
I am, yes.
Yay. Cool. Is this your third year?
Yeah, this will be my third year.
Nice.
Are you guys all dressing up as Freys?
I believe so. Or? I'm shopping for, like, Gambesons, which is weird.
Where do you do that?
Medieval Collectibles or something.
That is awesome.
I think the problem for me is I'd only be able to know if I could go quite last minute, and then like it all sells out months in advance.
Yeah, right? I don't think so. Yeah. There should be a lot of room at this place. So.
Oh, are they switching up to somewhere bigger?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I could potentially turn up. But also, I've never done that whole dressing up thing.
Well, you don't have to. I mean,
yeah, everybody... you have to.
I think you could really go as a Jedi. I think that would be acceptable.
That would be amazing.
I mean, do you not think you'd look odd if you weren't dressed up, though?
No. About half the people don't dress up, I would say.
I don't think Amin dressed up the first year.
Yeah, I don't think the first year too many people. Oh, I shouldn't say that.
Is it quite, like, picky? Like, did the sort of, I don't know.
A little bit, but I mean, you know, you can really talk with anyone because you have stuff to talk about, yeah. So.
I don't know, I live in fear of social exclusion.
Well, you come with a built-in clip,
yeah.
Though.
Yeah.
I mean,
the podcast of
Ice. You'd be one of the cool girls in this case.
Yeah, I'm like the cool girl.
I said in this case.
Actually, what are you, the cool girl? Or... are you the Heather of this scenario?
No. I would say we are about the third or fourth coolest clique there, so.
Really?
Whoa.
We are, what are the other coolest clique at a Son of Ice and Fire Fest.
That's kind of disappointing.
That's true.
Our final segment was recorded in April of 2016 and was in fact never intended to be an episode of VOK. It was an April Fool's joke orchestrated by Amin, in which several vassals performed a transcript of the very first episode of a podcast of Ice and Fire. It was published as episode 191 of the Mother Podcast. What follows here are the outtakes and aftershow of that recording.
Should I do a really offensive Southern accent? I don't know if I could keep it up the whole time, but she does say, I'm from
y'all.
Texas.
I'm from Texas, y'all. You can add little twangs and stuff in there like that, like
random,
or if yeah, you can paraphrase a little here and there, or you know, if you think it makes sense.
Yeah,
it's gonna be perfect, guys. Just say.
Basically, just try to keep going is what I would say.
Yeah, because it's a little hard to like going. Read and not sound like you're reading.
I think Kyle would have to come by the forums once in a while to ban people.
Ooh, oh, you know what? You should be eating something while you do this. Kyle. You're just like, no. Yeah.
There's some rappers in the background.
Yeah.
Oh my god, that's so awesome!
I love this new sweet onion chicken teriyaki.
It should just randomly interject.
Yeah. Like, Firehouse subs, they're the best. They're not paid to say this, but...
That's fabulous.
He's from California, right? I'll drop like In-N-Out or whatever.
Oh, In-N-Out.
Well, McDonald's is what he was eating on the podcast.
Oh, no. You just got to be like, the In-N-Out truck pulled up outside my... I had to have some In-N-Out truck. It's the best. When multiple people, when it says multiple people laugh, we should all just go, ha ha, ha ha, ha.
Sorry.
I'm gonna edit that out.
I've been laughing the entire time. I had to mute myself.
Mute yourself.
Blood oranges.
With all the blood oranges.
Well, I have two answers.
You have to whisper. It has to be blood oranges.
All right. Stop. Three.
Sorry, I fucked up.
Three, two, one, go.
Beavers.
And so that concludes our Song of Ice and Fire podcast by George R. R. Martin. Oh, fuck.
Yay.
Have a good night.
You'll be my favorite person ever if you can edit blood oranges after the line where Aaron says you like your lemons and oranges.
Yeah, I can probably fix
on page
that.
On page 52. This is page 52.
Oh my goodness.
Imagine if all of our recorders failed and we hadn't actually recorded this.
I have my Darkling plane. But yeah.
Don't even say it.
No, I just like.
Sorry, people, fucked it all up.
We're cutting out here. That's what I was going to say. Because we are having like thunderstorms right now. Like randomly, the sky opened up. And so there are a few points where people cut out. But I don't know. I don't think it was that bad. But. I'll probably just...
Okay, so Adam, was that you that said America's not ready for a female ruler?
I was trying to,
and also,
I was trying to figure out what he said.
And also, who said...
Adam, do not admit to that.
No, because...
Also, who said...
Farley. Because it was...
Who said, don't fear the Reaver? That was brilliant.
Maybe that was me.
I almost lost it on don't fear the Reaver.
Okay, inaudible. I just had to make something up. And like, well, but
so, Ella, and you also sounded like you were having a fit a little bit.
I was trying to, like, I don't know, I couldn't figure out the range on that. I was just going all over the place with it. But he well, that one where he said like, yeah, West, you know, I don't think, you know, that the Ironborn are ready for a female leader, just like inaudible. I'm like, fuck. But he's a Canadian, and it is 2008, and Hillary is running for election, so he's probably thinking America.
Brilliant.
I mean...
Brilliant.
I don't know.
Yeah, you did a good job of, like, you know, copying Amin's way of speaking a little bit. Like,
yeah,
you
know, good.
I mean, it was...
A few places I purposely didn't, on, but...
It was... Yeah, you got really into it. It was really good, yeah.
Oh my goodness, thank you, Casey. Shit.
No problem. Thank you, that's really good work.
How long did that take?
Gotten use out of it.
How long did it take you? I don't want to know. How long did it take you?
Let's see, so I think I got the, like, Amin gave it to me sometime at the beginning of when I joined, so like February.
Oh my gosh.
And I think it took me about a month, but that was me I wasn't doing it every day. So definitely, like, it didn't take me as long as... It took me a month to get it done, but it didn't take me actually that long.
Yeah.
Well, if you think that is bad, there is MuggleCast, and they have volunteer transcribers. Like, people volunteer for every episode to...
The what?
Transcribe. So MuggleCast, Harry Potter podcast.
Oh, so people,
there's people that
transcribe it, like, for
every
for the death,
episode.
Maybe, or...
Oh, God.
What is...
No, I think they do it to translate it to other languages, right?
No, I think it's just they write the transcripts of each of the episodes, and, like, some of those episodes are, like, 2 hours, 2.5 hours.
That's crazy. What was that? I wasn't paying attention. How much longer did it take us than an hour?
Well, we started at about
not too much
5:20 or so. So an hour and like 20 some minutes, maybe.
Yeah, not too bad.
Sounds about right. Yeah.
Barley, when did you get here?
20 minutes ago.
Yeah, but then there's a fair amount of, like, dead space, which will hopefully be cut out, and a few, like, yes. Retakes. Like, there was less than 10 retakes, so it shouldn't be that hard to find and fix them, I hope.
Nice.
So,
yeah. What's going in the background in someone's...
That was me, sorry. I was dropping things.
Yeah, I told them not to really worry.
Perfect.
Because, yeah,
your mic...
I listened to the episode earlier today, and I'm like, man, there's so much keyboard typing and, like, all kinds of stuff going on, so...
Oh, the what was said to be sword play was actually my wife cutting up her dinner.
Same thing with the sword.
Yeah, yeah. That's about right.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Well, that was fun. We should do more Castle recordings, because this is kind of a...
I don't know how many more of these I can do, but
we could also
books and stuff where there's already a script. But yeah, I guess it's like
that's the best
retyping it and color coding it does kind of help. The first rule of secret VOK is you don't talk about secret VOK. So Matt is currently out.
God damn it! How to talk about wedding planning for 2 hours?
That's a no match club.
You should. You should start your own wedding planning club.
We have one that. We're allowed one.
That's so bad.
All of VOK is invited.
And... yeah, we'll Skype you in.
Aww. Oh, you should.
No, I mean, I really think we're just going to have, like, this huge Skype thing so people can actually see the ceremony.
Can you do a live podcast from your wedding?
VOK number 300.
Sure, I'll be like, hold on.
Well, she should be used to that by now, right?
Matt's wedding.
Yeah. If she doesn't support this, then this is not the right person.
This is episode one of Barley's wedding.
Aww.
For the it week just gets June. Worse from here on out. Are you trying to open up a treasure chest right now?
I don't know. What is that?
Oh, sorry. I thought I muted myself.
Typical Amber.
Yeah. I'm just wrestling beavers here.
Nice.
Oh, Adam. Sorry. Speaking of which, Adam, will you resend me the... Fury Road one, because I'm trying to practice editing, and for some reason that's gone now.
Do you want, like, the raw file, or the...
Yes.
Okay. Oh, baby, I like it raw!
I feel like this is a trick to get some, let's say, edited content out of there.
Edited content? Well, I can at least edit it for myself and not...
No, I'm just messing with you.
I don't know how to post anything anywhere, but it seems like a good one to practice on.
Oh, that's the feigned ignorance there. Oh, you know, I don't even know how to post things anywhere. I'm just a simple
What's
little country
computer?
Chicken.
I don't know.
Worked for me forever.
Oh, I'm on my phone. I'm Matt. I can only be on my phone.
This was a nice trip down memory lane, listening. Yeah. Well, experiencing the first podcast.
It takes me back
to 2011.
Must have
been like 7 years that I listened to
that.
I think it was 2012 when I listened to it.
It was like...
No, I definitely listened before 2010.
It was after the first season of Game of Thrones came out.
Because I was listening to the podcast when I was procrastinating for my final exams at school, and I finished school in 2010. So it must have been before then.
What year did the show begin?
2011.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I was, like, mid-2012.
Wow.
And I listened, like, the whole time through, and then I went back and I was gonna re-listen again as I rewatched the show, but I didn't get very far. There was just too much VOK.
I know I listened to all the episodes twice that were out at that time, or, like, three times even.
That's hard. Because
I was trying really hard not to study for my exam.
I happened to be at, like, I had a job where I had headphones in all the day, because it was, like, I had a really sweet job at the time, but it was only, like, a one-year contract, and I listened to, like, all the audiobooks a bunch of times,
went back to
podcasting, like, tons of podcasts, like, we weren't supposed to listen to headphones or anything, but I was out on my own, I was doing, like...
Such a rebel.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I started the podcast in 2009. I think it was 2009. It was definitely before the show came out, because I, you know, basically had just read all the books, and then I was like, I need to hear more about this. You know, what can I find? So I probably just Googled Ice and Fire podcast, and of course it would come up.
Yeah.
When did you start reading the books?
It was before, it was somewhere around that time. It was before Dan.
Before they were cool.
In theory.
Oh boy.
This guy I work with had given me, who's actually not, wasn't even like that big of a fan. He gave me the first Game of Thrones, and he was like, "Yeah, you should read this. It's okay."
Nice.
It's kind of book recommendation, though. I don't recommend okay books then.
Yeah, if you have absolutely nothing else to do.
It was along those lines, but like he had recommended Tad Williams to me, and I'd never really read much fantasy before. So I read the Tad Williams series that he liked, and he's like, "Well, hey, maybe you should check this out too." Oh, the one that's with it has elves in it basically, and that are called the Sethi. I'm blanking on what the titles are, and I mean the hero is like a lost prince.
Oh, is that the Dragonbone?
Yes, Dragonbone. Yes.
I read those way too long ago. I remember that they exist, but that's about it. So
isn't that weird?
I can't.
Like with some books you read, like these, we remember such little. We forget a lot, but there's all these little details because we're always talking about it. And other stuff, I'm like, oh, I loved that. What happened?
But how much would I remember of A Song of Ice and Fire if I hadn't been talking about it for the past couple of years?
Exactly.
Because I read the first book so many years ago.
No idea. Like, whew.
Yeah, but what about, like, Lord of the Rings, like, the first time you read that?
Yeah, but that was different. It's just been around my entire life. I can't even, like, I don't...
And how many times have you read it since?
I read that when I was
7. No, I mean, I think I read the first trilogy the first time at 9, so it took a long time to get onto the internet.
Yeah. Yeah, we didn't. I don't think we had a computer when I started reading it. Or maybe we did. No, I think we did. I think we did. But I didn't have my own. Long time ago.
Yeah, Lord of the Rings I actually didn't read until after the first movie.
Aww. Well, I haven't even read it, so I'm like a bad reader.
Well, see, that's a perfect reason. I hadn't read it until VOK did their reread, and I read along.
Really?
And that's a perfect way to do it. And you get to listen to Shellfish. He's awesome.
You listen to me, Shellfish.
No, you can't. No, you can't do Peter's.
There are
voice.
No substitutes.
Just don't. Just don't.
I can't do
you
it.
Do not believe,
no one
you
can.
You don't believe it is me, Shellfish?
No, now you sound like a Darth Vader.
Sean Connery.
How dare you not?
Okay, now we're Bane.
Gosh, when is the last time we heard from Maester Bane?
You will have my permission to die.
Your parachute's just filled with pots and pans.
Oh my.
Not oranges.
I did not get that until just right now. That it's blood oranges. Like blood raven.
Oh my god.
Citrus.
Oh, is there going to be an aftershow for this or no? I'll have to ask Amin what he wants.
Wait a minute, I thought we were in the aftershow.
But the blood, no, the but blood like, oranges needs to be in the... Please,
yeah,
please,
yeah.
Please, please, please.
No, but I don't know if he, if he wants to, like, just play it off, like, as a normal episode. And just,
right.
Like, which
maybe,
would be obvious after the first 5 minutes.
And Kyle's a girl.
Yeah, Kyle's a girl.
I think that was Amin's plan. I think he would have mentioned if we should do an after show or not, but she didn't, so
yeah.
I think...
So I'm going to get to editing it, and then I'll send him a message real quick and just ask him if specifics of what he wants, but we'll see.
Or maybe add it a couple of days later, like put it up without...
Yeah, well, we can always put it on VOK.
Oh, yeah.
We can just cut the content and put it like... I mean, it could be part of the 300, it could be, you know, whatever. We just piggyback it on the back of a random episode, you know, like we do.
And so ends our foray into the Darkling Plane. We leave you now with a compilation of songs devised and submitted by various vassals over the years. May their dulcet tones ferry you safely back to the land of the living. We bid you all a happy Halloween, but take heed, dear listener. A podcast is a precious thing. It must always have multiple recorders watching over it, and its editing must be courageous and swift, or it too may end up a casualty of this doomed domain. Farewell, and pray that we do not meet again. Thank you.
The wind blew across the dusty plain as the Northmen rode along. The quiet wolf of a winter fell, and six bannermen leal and strong. For the she-wolf who had aroused a war, they'd hunted low and high. They rode up to their destiny, 'neath the lonely Tower of Joy. The tower stood alone, framed by the blood-red mountains of dawn. And three brave men stood beneath those stones, tall and proud that fateful morn. Their white cloaks billowing in the wind, they held their heads and honor high. Prepared to do their duty 'neath the lonely Tower of Joy. The white bull and the black bat, side by side with Sir Arthur Dane. The sword of the morning sadly smiled as wind stirred his silver mane. The great sword dawn strapped to his back, forged from a fallen star. They waited for the Northmen as they rode up from afar. The quiet wolf spoke softly and fixed them with his steely glare. "I looked for you on the trident," the bull replied, "we were not there. You were not at King's Landing, nor the surrender of Storm's End. Oh, we are of the Kingsguard, and our knees do not easily bend. Sir Darry fled with queen and prince, they sailed across the sea. But we are of the Kingsguard, and the Kingsguard do not flee. Now it begins," Sir Arthur said. Unsheathing dawn, he waved her high. "No, now it ends," said the quiet wolf, "neath the lonely Tower of Joy." The battle joined in a rush of steel, the seven and the three. But above that clashing storm of swords, they heard a woman's plea. The she-wolf howled out, "Eddard!" in a long and mournful cry. As a storm of blue rose petals swirled across a blood-streaked sky. The Kingsguard held their honor, it was their duty to defend. With valor, skill, and courage, they fought to the bitter end. But when that fateful morn was done, there stood but only two: the quiet wolf and the Crannog man, his friend both leal and true. The wolf pulled down the tower, the final act was at an end, and used those stones to build their cairns to honor foe and friend. 'Neath those mountains, all that stands are stone cairns pointing to the sky. They're the only lonely echoes left of that lonely Tower of Joy. They're the only lonely echoes left of that lonely tower of joy.
This land is your land. This land is my land. From Slaver's Bay to the last city island, from the cold hard forest to the great grass sea, I tell you, this land was made for you and me. As I went walking down that dripping of a demon's road, I saw above me, oh, that endless dragon horde. Now I saw below me unconquered terrain, and I said, this land was made for the Valyrian expansion.
To be seen in this red waste desolation, am I Khaleesi, am I queen? The fire is raging like this swirling storm inside. Could not walk in even if I fried. I must walk in and let them see, be the dragon I was always meant to be. Don't turn, don't burn with my Drogo. And now they know. Let it go, let it go. Can't hold it back anymore. Let it go, let it go. No more dreams of that red door. Let the dragon awake as this night meets a day. Let the fire rage on. The heat never bothered me anyway. It's funny how some king's blood makes everything seem small. And the fears that once controlled me, I can't get to me at all. It's time to see what I can do to test the limits and break through. No right, no wrong, no rules for me. I'm free. Let it go, let it go. power, ride on the wind and fly. Let it go, let it go. You'll never see me fry. Here I'll stand till the light of a day. Let the fire rage on. The fire is burning from my hair down to the ground. The flames are spiraling like blazing, braiding all around. And one thought burns right through me like a fiery blast. I'm never looking back, the past is in the past. Let it go, let it go. And I rise at the break of dawn. Let it go, let it go. That timid girl is gone. Here I'll stand in the light of day. Hear the dragon's song. The heat never bothered me anyway.
No, my lady, it's too hot.
Hi there, nice to be with you. Happy you could stick around. Like to introduce me, Mo Mieville drums. And Kyle Maddock rhythm pole. And Amin Javadi bass guitar. And Ashley piano. Come in, Vassals of Kingsgrave on the saxophone. With Vassals of Kingsgrave on tenor sax. Hi, Victorian Greyjoy, trumpet. Big hello to Big Tormund Giantsbane, xylophone. And Mance Raider, guitar. The Queen of Thorns, spoons. And looking very relaxed, Ramsey Bolton on vibes. Nice. Sansa Stark on sousaphone. Introducing the Blackfish, clarinet. With Peter Middle Finger Baelish on vocals. Joffrey Lannister and his pals tap dancing. In the Groove with Eddard Stark, violin. And Robert Baratheon on harmonica. Over there, Tywin Lannister, ukulele. Hi, Tywin. My left, Master Aemon Targaryen, bass sax. A great honor, sir. And specially flown in for us, a session source on Vox Humana. Nice to see Lord Tyrion Lannister on euphonium. Drop out with Commander Jon Snow on duck call. Hearing from you later, Sam Tarly on horn. Yeah. Digging Sir Barristan Selmy on accordion. Really wild, General, thank you, sir. Khal Drogo on trigger. Tune in Wildlings and Free Folk on bongos. The Golden Company on triangle. Thank you. Great to hear House Frey on trombone. Back from his recent operation, Jamie Lannister, harp. And representing the flower people, the mountain on bells. Wonderful to hear Jojen Reed on banjo. We welcome George R.R. Martin as himself. Very appealing, Marjorie Tyrrell. That's nice, Marge. What a team, Brienne of Tarth and Podrick Payne on percussion. And a great favourite and a wonderful performer of all of us here, Daenerys Targaryen on gong.
My name is Amberrocks and I come to say, y'all should check out VOK each and every day. Our lack of knowledge may be shocking and our humor quite basic, Flame APOIAF, cause they cold started this place. From the M to the A to the A to the K, they made it possible for all of us to be here today. When you step to VOK, son, you better step hard. We can take on any army, any fucking Kingsguard. If you're trolling, check your dealings. Kingsgrave will leave you ruined. With tact and respect is how we share our feelings. Look for dragons from the moon, winter's coming real soon. If you wanna fuck with us, we'll cut your heart out with a spoon. I hope you're realizing, ain't no good antagonizing. The place is here, the time is now, the man with E is rising.
Well, there's Nadia and the Beaner, Valkyrist from down under, a shellfish, a pod, ladies Griffin and Gray, and we love their Skype chatter, from Tolkien to Blatter, they're the bastards and vassals, all leal to King's Grave, all leal to King's Grave, all leal to King's Grave, they're the bastards and a vassal, all leal to King's Grave. Now Jess likes to scribble, and Vic tends to giggle, FT Ward, Biggest Rivers, and Lord Manderbly. And their chapter's recital is a listen most vital. They're the bastards and the vassals, all leal to King's Grave, all leal to King's Grave, all leal to King's Grave. They're the bastards and the vassals, all leal to King's Grave. Ted Art Eiffel and Zach, Inca's Reign and Sir Pat, Erinese and East Texas, and no true lady. And the thoughts of these sages will echo down through the ages. They're the bastards and the vassals, all leal to King's Grave, all leal to King's Grave, all leal to King's Grave. They're the bastards and the vassals, all leal.